hole. Here, let me grab it for you real quick while I'm thinking of it.
Hey, dude, can you pass me that red backpack up there?
Chris Cole, the man who takes fantastic photos and posts them faster than I can even think about what happened on TV. Here's the base. Do you need the mount? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Principal Anna Dassing, Athletic Director Frank Torcasio, and Head Baseball Coach B.J. McConnell, this is James Byrne welcoming you to Lucy Beckham High School for tonight's crosstown rivalry matchup between the Wildcats of West Ashley High School and the Bengals of Lucy Beckham. A special welcome to the families and fans of West Ashley High School as you join us for tonight's game. Also, an administrative note, although this game is being played at Lucy Beckham, tonight's home team is West Ashley, and tonight's visiting team is the Lucy Beckham Bengals. Stay safe tonight, fans. Please use the crosswalk when making your way between the baseball complex and the parking lot this evening. And be sure to press the button to activate the flashing yellow lights. Keep an eye out for baseballs and other objects leaving the field of play. Please return foul balls and any other equipment to the nearest dugout.
Torcasio was texting me the other day. He's like, I hear everything that's going on up there. A great interview, but it's on the speakers.
Well, thanks for paying attention. Like, we thought you'd want to listen to it. I'll be back in when I...
Turn the power on those two. see the toys on that?
Whoa. What's the pressure wash? You getting pressure wash on where you? Go ahead, put it in stadium.
Jesus.
Two bits!
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the starting lineup for the West Ashley Wildcats. Leading off, batting first, number 11, playing center field, Reese Swander. Batting second, right fielder number 2, Maddie Brown. Batting third, playing third base, number 12, David Stallworth. Batting fourth, your shortstop, number 13, Zach Russell. Batting fifth, playing left field, number 3, Tate Westervelt. Batting sixth, first baseman, number 20, Henry Wood. Batting seventh, tonight's starting pitcher, number 15, Corey Brain. Batting eighth, the catcher, number 19, Tyler Jimenez. And batting ninth, second baseman, number 5, Reed Lunsford. West Ashley is coached by Mr. Christopher Daig, assisted by Mr. Brian Willis, Connor Travis, and Matt Campbell.
Oh, can you go with our lineup? Or our lineup.
And now your Lucy Beckham Bengals. Leading off, center fielder number 11, Kevin Fagan. Batting second, first baseman number 12, Riles Morris. Batting third, your catcher number 2, Perrin Ketchen. Batting fourth, tonight's designated hitter number 9, Hank Epley. Batting fifth, number 6, left fielder, Kingston Kolb. Batting 6th, second baseman, number 3, Tommy Byrne. Batting 7th, number 17, Keegan Conroy. Batting 8th, third baseman, number 5, Andrew Hoover. And batting 9th, right fielder, number 19, Gabe Johnson. Your starting pitcher tonight is number 10, Holman Blake. The Bengals are coached by Mr. B.J. McConnell, assisted by Vic Major, Kyle Statz, and Andrew Taylor. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand if you are able. Remove your caps and direct your attention to the American flag in center field as we honor our nation and those who have served it over the past 250 years. Thank you. A quick correction to the Bengals starting lineup. Number 2, Perrin Ketchen, will be the starting shortstop. And number 17, Keegan Conroy, will be the starting catcher. Taking on the West Ashley Wildcats. Since this was originally supposed to be played over at West Ashley High School as a road game, they're sticking to the same format, and tonight, your Bengals, playing on home turf, will be the visiting team. Now batting! Now batting, number 11, Kevin Fagan! Blake Brain, starting pitcher for West Ashley Wildcats this evening. Heading up to the hill. They're getting a few details worked out before they throw the first pitch here. We've had the national anthem, we've had the player introductions, we've had the meeting at the plate. And now on this beautiful, freshly mowed Lucy Beckham field, we're going to play some baseball. Corey Brain, the pitcher, sets up in the windup, and the first pitch at 6:30 on the nose is wide for ball one.
Did we do that? We got everything off on time?
I think we might have actually, Matt. I think we might have actually hit the post, as they say in the business.
I like it. Not many hiccups, so. We're getting this down to a science.
Ball and two strikes now on Fagan. Leadoff batter for the Bengals. Like I said, the Bengals will be batting in the top half of each inning tonight. And a foul ball down the first base line keeps the count at 1-2.
Jim, who do we have here in the booth with us tonight?
Well, we have a smaller crowd than we normally do tonight. Of course, to my right, the man working the... Oh, and it's a hit batsman. Kevin Fagan's going to reach safely. And that's how we start things off here on this Thursday night baseball game. The man working the switches and in my left ear is none other than Matt Stanley. Now batting, number 12, Riles Morris.
Mile-an-hour off-speed pitch. We got all the toys up today, Jim.
Actually, we've got more than just the original toys here. We've got some new flags on the microphones, and we've got a pickoff attempt over to first base. Nothing happening on that. We've got some new soundproofing up here, trying to improve the sound quality. We've got some foam pads and...
Let's call that floating soundproofing.
Floating!
Like floating floors.
Counter height. Morris takes the outside pitch, and it's 1-1. Riles Morris had a nice ball game last night, got the bat a little warmed up, had a nice double out there. Playing out in Culloden County last night. They went out on a field trip out to the country, and they came back with a 6-4 win last night. That swept the series from Culloden County this week. Nice to have a couple of region wins in the pocket. And now it's a ball and a strike here on the first baseman.
Oh,
that's a chop towards second base. He will not have time to get the
double play. Second baseman tried for it at second. And it looks like Fagan slid right underneath it. He's kind of dusting off the leg there.
Yeah, on those big bad hops, you got to get the ball out quickly. And that's not the run you're going to get it out on.
Now batting number two, Aaron Ketchin.
Wristband at the plate. Figures out what call we're making. And he's ready to play. Drops the bat into a bunt position. First baseman starts to crash in.
Yeah, it's an easy way to see if we still got the bunt on. Little pickoff attempt, see if he squares.
Now he's shown bunt, so we'll see if that changes the Wildcats approach. Wildcats wearing their home white, Bengals wearing the gray.
Got the ball in the dirt. Aaron ahead in the count, 2-0. Two runners on, no outs. Top of one. Used to saying bottom of one, good night.
Not tonight, Matt.
And just used to being the bottom ones. There's one.
Two balls and a strike here now on Ketchin. Steps back into the box. Dave Schrock behind me, he's the third man up here in the booth. Now bunt is shown again. This is laid down nicely towards the pitcher's mound.
Did your job. Got him around, runners in scoring position.
A 1-4 put out over to first base, and now Fagan and Morris both stand at scoring position.
Yeah, look at that.
Now batting, number 9. Hank Epley.
Epley waits on a pitch he can deal with. That's not going to be the one. That one's outside and knocked down quickly. Tyler Jimenez got behind that pitch. Kept it out in front of him. He's the catcher tonight for the Wildcats. And now here's the second pitch, and it's a 1-1 count. Corey Brain now switched to the stretch. Right-handed pitcher looks over at Kevin Fagan and delivers outside, counts 2-1. Epley is tonight's designated hitter. He swings away.
Unintentional bunt. Swinging bunt. But does the job.
That thing didn't travel more than about 20 feet. But it brought the run in. And Kevin Fagan is the first man to touch home plate tonight. So it's 1-0 here in the top of the first inning with the Bengals on top.
Now batting number 6, Kingston Kolb.
And we're back. Jim, who we got officiating this game?
It's the guy behind the plate and the guy out there in the field. They're both wearing black.
Both of them.
Yes. Mr. Blue and Mr. Sir.
If this guy just stays hot.
Kingston Kolb has been all over it. This guy's batting almost .500 right now. He is just a hit machine. And quite honestly, he's been an extra bases hit machine. He has had doubles. I think he leads the team right now.
Got it.
And yeah. If he doesn't lead in extra base hits, I can't imagine who does. He's moved up in the lineup a spot tonight. He's actually a couple of spots. He's usually batting 6th or 7th. Well, here he is in the 5 hole. And a gentleman and a scholar as he goes over and picks up Mr. Jimenez's mask for him. That last pitch bounced off of Jimenez's toe and got away from him and dropped the mask trying to find it. Now it's a ball and two strikes. Two outs here at the top of the first inning. Almost another hit batsman. That was how Kevin Fagan started things off. He reached on a plunk to the left hip, and now he's sitting in the dugout, having scored the first run. Riles Morris over at third base. And here's the pitch. It's fouled back.
Yeah, if they had all-star ballots, he'd be a first rounder here in
high school.
Oh, there's
no question. No question.
And if all these scouting services, PG, PBR, these guys don't know his name yet, they will soon.
And here's another base hit. This one's going to touch the grass. Going to be one, but it'll be an RBI. Kingston Kolb stays hot. And another base hit for the left fielder. Now batting, number three, Tommy Byrne.
Jim Byrne over here doing multiple tasks, filming. Swing and miss. Tommy, little. Ooh. What was that? That was a little 63 mile an hour curve. Tommy's hungry, first pitch. We got a pickoff attempt at first. Jim Byrne doing double duty tonight. Daddy, play by play.
Indeed. Trying to do a little bit of each here. I'll bring you eight batters. Matt will bring you number nine.
Tell you, I'd like to see these guys, put the bat on the ball, move the ball around while we're here in this first inning, early part of the game. If we can come out punching, I think we have a good chance at coming away with a victory tonight.
Well, inside pitch brings the count to 2-1 here. Jimenez working hard trying to keep that ball in front of him so that Kingston Kolb doesn't get a free base.
Kingston getting a decent lead out there. There we go, and
Tommy
there's a shot to the
hole.
His runner. That's a beautiful. Oh, and it gets through!
That's going to be an extra base!
That's going to score
That's going to bring Kingston around. Tommy Byrne around second. He's coming
there
to third.
There we go. Uh-oh, another error. There we go. All right, catcher's saying, let's settle down, everybody. Timeout.
So a base hit from Tommy Byrne brings Kingston Kolb all the way around from first, and just like that, the Bengals have a 3-0 lead, and we're going to have Keegan Conroy coming to the plate. Now batting. Now batting, number 17, Keegan Conroy.
There we go. Come on, he's got the legs. He's got the legs.
Here's the throw. He's got it.
He's got it.
He is safe at first.
He's in there. There we go.
Everybody waited on a second to make the call as if he wanted to see if that ball was caught, but I'm pretty well convinced that Conroy was already across the plate.
I'm seeing a mohawk or a mullet out there. Here we go. We got time to play his music. He deserves some music. Let's go, boy.
Now batting, number 5, Andrew Hoover.
On the dirt. Our Bengals 4-1 so far. Let's keep it going. What do we know? What do we got here? Resurrection of the early season Bengals. Ooh, multitask here. Jim, I'm looking for communicators.
A lot of things going on up here in the booth. Of course, we are without the assistance tonight of one Jimmy Doyle. Jimmy, of course, over at Park West Recreation Complex tonight. He's over there coaching up the B team, those young Jungle Cats, is their name.
That's 30.
30 pitches into the night so far. Wildcats trail by 4, and it's a 3-0 count on Hoover. And that's a free pass. So the Bengals will hit the bottom of the lineup here.
Nobody. Number 19, Gabe Johnson.
Another one we had to pick some music for tonight. Why these guys haven't picked out their walk-up songs is beyond me.
Gabe Johnson starts tonight in right field. Nice to see that young man again. His only other appearance so far has been on the mound. Had a good night over at James Island last week.
Love that we're seeing the young guys, the first year varsity guys. Nice to see the coach has confidence in everybody on the bench. Get the experience now, and it'll pay off later in the season.
It's hard to believe because we've already seen a lot of baseball. We are still relatively early in the season. We still have a hit tournament to get to, and we've got a bunch of region play still with Hilton Head, Bluffton, May River, all still on the schedule down the bottom corner of the state. Johnson on a 1-2 pitch, fouls one back. He's got two on, two out. Runners at first and second. And I believe that's Hunter Doyle out there running for Keegan Conroy. Is that? Did I miss a courtesy runner there? Here's a throwback to second. And after a quick stumble, that's going to take him off the bases. Who was that? Is that Keegan or was that Hunter?
It looks like Hunter.
Yeah, I believe that was Hunter. He kind of stumbled over his shoelace getting back. He had a generous lead off of second, and the catcher just called him on it. And that'll do it. But the Bengals strike first and strike hard. It's 4-0 at the middle of one. And Holman Blake will take the mound. Getting ready to try to put a lid on this and end it early. Last night's B-team game sure ended early. That was a four-inning affair. Final score was, I believe, 15-0 against Georgetown. And, of course, a little bit of a grudge match there as head coach B.J. McConnell is of Georgetown fame. Coach McConnell having come to us from Georgetown after his last few seasons over there. Matt, I don't know about you, but I can smell the grill getting hot down there. I can smell those burgers and hot dogs sizzling below us. Now batting number 11, center fielder Reese Swander. Starts things off nicely with a called strike. That clunk you might have heard was a foul ball rolling off the steel roof of the hitting facility over there. Looks like it was a comebacker. And now another one. That's a hot shot towards Vic Major, Vic Major, sponsored by the Arthur Murray School of Dance, as he gets just out of the way of that one. I think that was a cha-cha. Maybe a tango that he had to do to jump over that thing. Still has the rose in his mouth. 0-2 count. And now an air ball gives him a 1-2. Reese Swander's your batter. We're in the bottom of the first inning here. Lucy Beckham playing visitor in tonight's game, even though it was relocated from West Ashley to Lucy Beckham. Here's a ball on the ground. Nice, that should be nice, an easy one for Perrin Ketchum. And in fact it is. There's one away here in the bottom of the first inning.
Starting to see some choppers on this this field here.
Now batting, number two, right fielder, Maddie Brown.
Maddie Brown at the plate. Lefty versus lefty here on this matchup. And the first pitch he gets, it's a little high. Keegan Conroy working behind the dish today. The Bengals veteran starting catcher, Hank Epley, is taking the role of designated hitter today. And another inside pitch makes it a 2-0 count.
Maddie Brown, North Greenville University commit. We're actually going to have Maddie's mom join us up here in just a little while. Miss Brown, Miss Katie Brown, is an infamous baseball mom here in Charleston. And can't wait to get her on and get her take and see what she thinks of our... what do we call this? I know this is the Beck. Oh, Kevin, he's going deep.
That ball, that's almost over. That ball is a double to the fence right out there at the second B in the word baseball. If you're watching, if you lost track of that thing, it was because it was smacked hard to the fence.
Yeah, I thought Kevin was giving up on that one. Just turned and looked the other way as if there was no more room, but. Feel safe.
Now batting, number 12, third baseman, David Stallworth.
I think David here is a College of Charleston commit, if I remember correctly. Switch hitter. Great ball player. A lot of these guys at West Ashley grew up playing together.
They did. They played with the Rocks for a long time. A lot of these guys played travel ball with the St. Andrews Rocks, and of course West Ashley's had a B team much longer than Lucy Beckham. Of course they've had a baseball team and a school a lot longer, so they came together and started playing high school ball a little bit earlier.
I think Keegan might have bought him when looked like that could have been maybe a ball at that time. What do we got going on over the tennis court today? Full court.
Talk about that.
Oof.
Oh, not going to get the call. A ball and two strikes. That was a pretty looking pitch, and I thought it grabbed the outside edge.
Yeah, I thought Keegan was able to push that back in, but I think he pushed it about as far as he could. Just missed.
Did a nice job trying to frame it.
Ooh, he did. Yep. Check him. Yes, he did.
And the call was made. He did go around. Keegan Conroy with the smart move making the extra tag.
Kevin and looks like the outfielders have some dance out here. Jim, I don't know if you saw that.
I did not, but we're going to make an announcement here real quick.
Now batting, shortstop number 13, Zach Russell.
Holman Blake asked for a different baseball here, so we'll pause for a moment. And while we do so, I'm going to look out there toward the tennis courts, and I do see what looks to be a blonde mohawk or mullet sticking up just outside the perimeter of this ball field. What is that out there, man?
Let's see if we can get in there a little more.
Migrating geese?
I'm not sure what that is. A wolverine or a chupacabra? I'm not sure what's out there. Let's see if you can get out there with that camera. Figure out what's going on.
Oh, we've got a passed ball here. He's going to give up one base, but no other harm done.
Just looks like we've got some spectators in us. Want to enjoy some baseball today. Can't blame them. Oh, he rips one down.
Zach Russell puts one in play. That's on the foul ball side. Woo. That is, thickness of a nickel. That thing was foul.
I tell you.
Call Mr. Blue. I told you these guys were good looking and had good vision.
Yeah, Jim, the way they've designed this field, that really helps the umpire. There was a bunch of sand that kicked up down the left field line when that thing hit just foul. That sand helped kick it up and put an exclamation point on it.
Yeah, you really can see where this ball comes. And a hit batsman. So we're going
to... He's got to go back. Yep.
It's going to be Matty Brown who tried to come home, but the ball is dead on the hit batsman. And Zach Russell takes a free pass down to first base. That one was on his toes.
Now batting, number three, left fielder, Tate Westervelt.
Yeah, what I was saying is after the last strikeout, I don't know if you saw this, and the viewers at home, they can sort of pay attention to this. I think the outfielders have created a synchronized dance, just like synchronized swimmers.
After
a strikeout. I saw this after Holman's strikeout. They sort of did some kind of happy dance. Going to have to keep an eye out for that.
Yeah, definitely something to look for. I'm not sure. Maybe they had a coupon with Vic Major because Vic sure danced out of the way of that foul ball.
Yeah, coach has definitely emphasized this week getting back to having fun playing the game.
Got to have fun. If you're not having fun, why are you doing it? And now a pickoff attempt over to first base. Just to try to keep Zach Russell honest. Runners at the corners here, two on, two out. It's 4-0 Lucy Beckham on top of the Wildcats here in the bottom of the first inning. And as we said, Lucy Beckham is playing visitor, even though it's their field. Oh, that's going to be a problem. That's going to bring Matty Brown in. That throw down to second got outside of the glove of Tommy Byrne. He was trying to stretch over the base runner, and it just got past the end of his glove to center field. So now 4-1. The runner at second. Matty Brown puts the first run on the board for the Wildcats. And an inside pitch gets blocked up by Keegan Conroy.
Not sure if you can see this at home, but compliments to the groundskeeping crew with the striping.
Yeah, the mowing looks great. If you can't see it, it's the alternating 6-foot wide stripes. Holman gets a strike back there. It's 2-2 now. One on, two out. Striping runs straight out from home plate toward the outfield wall. Now Blake delivers, and it's fouled off. That was an 80-mile-an-hour pitch. And the count stays firm at 2-2.
Let's see if Holman's got his good stuff today. Because I want to see that dance again, to be honest with you.
Here's the pitch. This ball is up and foul once again. This one over the right side, out of play.
A little hit and run.
That was definitely a hit and run. Zach Russell was about halfway past Heron Ketchum to third base by the time that ball crossed the plate. The payoff pitch once again from Holman is a strikeout. Well, we won't see the dance right here because these boys are coming in to swing some bats. At the end of the first inning, Lucy Beckham on top of the Wildcats. It's 4-1. you who can hear the music in the background, it's the Buttercup song.
Can't hear this and not sing, right, Matt?
Can't do it.
Don't break my heart. And those of you of a certain age will also not be able to hear this song and not think of something about Mary.
Favre.
What's that?
Brett Favre.
Brett Favre. The Pac-Man. One of the best comedies. Gotta love Something About Mary. If you have not seen it, make it a night for mom and dad. Don't invite the kids. Why do you fill me up, Buttercup baby, just to let me down? Best being done and then worst of all. You didn't pay for the singing, but you got it for free, folks.
They got their money's worth.
Gabe Johnson.
So since the last inning was ended on the bases, we'll have Gabe Johnson coming back to the plate to start things off here in the second inning. Now batting number 19, Gabe Johnson. Gabe Johnson was at the plate when courtesy runner Hunter Doyle was taken in a pickoff. He had a generous lead at second base, and catcher just looked up and called him on it, and I think he might have tripped over a shoelace or something. Mm. Johnson puts one sky high towards left field.
Got a good piece of that.
Out there just in the under. Corner, Tate Westervelt calls everybody off, and he'll take care of it. And I'm looking down across the top of this, and I see the Meekins group. Megan Meekins and Hobie Meekins, and I gotta wish a happy early birthday to somebody down there. Kevin Fagan at the top of the lineup knocks the first pitch he sees out to shortstop, and there's two away. Now batting, number 12, Riles Morris. So a little bit less action in the top of the second than we saw in the top of the first. Of course, the Bengals in the first inning were able to put runs on the plate with two away, and so we'll look to see if we can get some of that going again here in the second. 1-1 pitch on Riles Morris. Morris facing Corey Brain for the second time today. And now a 2-1 count on him. Dave Schrock doing double duty behind me tonight. Not only is he running game changer as he usually does, he's also taking care of the scoreboard as Jimmy Doyle hopefully coaching that B team up to another win. They had a great night last night. Tonight they're facing Lang. Check in on them here in just a second.
He also serves as the alternate sound mixer guy.
Yes. Dave reaching over, pushing buttons.
Making sure we don't have open mics at the Beck.
Full count now here on Riles Morris. Bengals on top over in the B team game at Park West. And
there's
here's a
shot. That's
to
getting
left
down.
Field.
That's getting down.
That's getting down there, and it touches the grass. It's a base hit for Riles Morris. So a two out single. Puts Bengals on the bases and brings Perrin Ketchum to the plate.
Happy with what I'm seeing here. I talked to Riles the other day, and you can tell.
Now batting number 2, Perrin Ketchum. Ketchum takes strike number 1, looking at it. Looks like the Lucy Beckham B team is doing a good job of handling the Lang Braves over there at Park West High School. Park West Recreation Complex. Over on Park West Boulevard. Field number one if you're heading over that way. It's 11-3 in the game over there. Let's check in and see where they are in this game.
Yeah, I want to go back to Riles for just a second. I spoke with him this last week, and you can kind of tell the mental side of baseball is, you know, probably crept its way in and starting to affect him. And, you know, how is he, you know, how does coach see me? And you know, what's the mental side, you know? And we'll talk to Katie about this. But, you know, I just simply asked him, where do you bat in the lineup? Third? Have you moved? No? Nobody's lost confidence in you. You're one swing away. Just take all that pressure off yourself. Forgive yourself. Move on. Take what's there. You know what I mean? And that's what we saw there. That's the old Riles that I'm starting to see come back around, is taking the shots that are given to him.
Yeah, all very good points. It's a very mental game. You know, Riles is a gunslinger when it comes to swinging that bat. And he just wants to hit bombs. He wants to make it rain out there. And a lot of times he's been in that position where he's been called on to bunt and, you know, play small ball, which Riles is a consummate teammate, and he will always do his part. But it's frustrating. He knows that he can hit the long ball, and he wants to hit it. But, you know, he's been called on to do a job. And
now he's been called on to run, hit and run. Beautiful execution.
Oh, run action there.
Oh.
And that ball got away from the first baseman.
Yeah.
Perrin Ketchen reaches safely on the drop throw. And Riles Morris will trot over to third base. So, like we said earlier, two-out rallies seem to be the way that Lucy Beckman's going to play baseball tonight.
Now batting. Number 9, Hank Epley.
Hank Epley, tonight's designated hitter, batting for Holman Blake, comes up to the plate. And a two-out, two-on situation with the runners at the corners will start things off with a pickoff attempt over to first.
Now, Riles, when you do your film study on this, I want you to look at how you rounded second base, buddy. You want to anticipate that throw is a bad throw and come around that base harder. Fake to third. Come around that base a little hard because he got a good jump. And I saw him ease up as he went into second base, but you got to anticipate that and get aggressive around that base hard.
Epley thought about it. Catcher's going to ask for the appeal, and the base umpire says no, he didn't. So ball and no strikes. Two on, two out. Here in the top of the second inning, Lucy Beckham on top, 4-1. Not threatening again here now.
It was a weird move. It almost looks like the pitcher went down to a knee.
Corey Brame is the man on the mound for the West Ashley Wildcats. They're wearing their home white because this is a home game for them on the schedule, even though it's being played here at the Beck. At where?
The Beck.
And the outside edge finds the ball. And now it's 1-1. You're wondering who I was hollering at downstairs there. The Meekins group. These are former neighbors. West Ashley High School graduate, one of them. And first cousins to Kingston Cold here helping to support their cousin tonight. Perrin Ketchen takes the base over at second. He'll get credited with the stolen base there. And now 3-1 on Epley. 11-4 is the score in the B-team game over at the bottom of the third inning at Park West. And the count comes full on the designated hitter. Pitch was 53 miles an hour. Now Corey Brain comes set, working from the stretch. Here's the kick. Here's the pitch.
There's
another
one.
And that one's over the head of the second baseman, out in the right field.
Epley rounds first. Here's one. Here's two. 6-1. Lucy Beckham. Nice piece of hitting from this guy. Never trying to do too much, but always doing something. Hank Epley knocks two in. The Bengals keep up the two-out rallies, and it'll be Kingston Colb's turn. It's 6-1.
Now batting number six, Kingston Colb.
Kingston steps into the box, sees first pitch down and away. Sun has just finally dipped down below the tree line.
And you know that because you spent time here with Rob Fowler.
Indeed I did. I'm telling you, Matt, that was a fun ball game. That was a fun ball game and a fun ball game.
Oh, there we go. There's another boot. Yeah, let's get there.
That ball goes down to the third base side.
Uh-oh.
We might have an injured player.
We have an injury on the field.
That ball was a screamer down the third base line. And David Stallworth went for it. It kind of got booted, kind of came off the glove funny.
Hard hit, though.
Went over into the third base foul side.
Definitely a hard
hit. Chased after it.
That's a bad hop. That's got to be a hit.
Went down hard as he went for the ball, and he's walking it off now. Looks like he's going to be okay, but that was a hard hit ball and a tough play.
Yep.
Now batting number three, Tommy Byrne.
And we'll wait to see Tommy Byrne swing the bat as the Wildcats.
Well, we're going to see another pitcher here. Tommy's going to go take some pointers. And we're going to go to some wagon wheel. You see that? Why? Because we can't.
So that'll be all for
Tyler Anthony.
Corey Brain.
Coach's kid.
Number 17 is going to be Tyler Anthony coming into the game.
Good little ball player here too. Throws a lot of strikes. I'm not so sure I remember the sidearm so pronounced when I coached him, but that's definitely got some run on it.
And we'll go back to our stats, man. Dave, can we get line on how Corey Brain finished up his night? I believe we're going to have Corey Brain out of the game as both pitcher and hitter. He did not have a DH in the game. And we'll take a look at his stats for the night. Corey Brain left after 1 2/3, had 6 runs on 6 hits. 3 of those runs were earned. No strikeouts, 1 walk. He threw 58 to 31 batter.
Why don't you announce Tommy again?
Now batting number 3, Tommy Byrne.
31 strikes out of 58 pitches for Mr. Brain.
This is definitely going to be a strange look for these guys. They got to find the ball down low. Once they pick it up, it's starting to run. But everything seems to be running away, so I'd scoot up in front of the box and catch that thing out in front.
Two on, two out here for Tommy Byrne. Runners both in scoring position as the sidearm Tyler Anthony sends one in. Cold strike, now 1-1 on Tommy Byrne.
That one looked like it had a little sink on it.
6-1 is the score here, the top of the second. Bengals put 4 up in the first, 2 here so far. They've got 2 more threatening. And if Tommy Byrne can find a way to have that ball touch the grass, he's going to plate at least one, if not both of them.
Yep.
2-1 is the count now on the second baseman.
I don't do stats, but how's he doing? I don't look at the stats.
I didn't see what I did yesterday. I haven't looked at his in a while. I can't look him up right at the moment.
Yeah. Feeling good, though? Confident?
Feels good. Yeah, he says he is really trying to take more of a first pitch approach. He struggled during the fall season, that Diamond Prospect, seeing curveballs. He said he just couldn't quite pick them up. This is going to be a little bit of a different look for it as well. And now he swings away. It's 3-2. Seems to have beaten the curveball issue. He's worked on that a lot in the cages and in his private hitting lessons. By the way, I want to give a shout out to Ari Sakopoulos and Asteri Sports Performance over on Long Point Road.
Ooh, love it, love it, love it, love it. See another pitch. Way to hang in there, Tommy.
Count stays full now. 2-1, 2-out.
Seen a lot of pitches now. I think he's probably picked up on it.
What kind of speeds are we seeing off of Anthony?
That last one, I think we were somewhere between 65. I'm not sure if what I'm reading on the radar gun right now is.
And I thought he was going to let that one stay as a ball. He rode that last second swing, and that'll strand two.
70 miles an hour on the fastball.
So at the middle of two, it is 6-1, Lucy Beckham. So Tommy Burns, glove and hat, wait for him out at second base. That was... Sorry, we're getting a couple of things going here. I know that was a frustrating way to end that inning for the Beckham Bengals, especially for... there himself. Really wanted to bring those runs in and bring the RBIs to his stat line, but he'll have more chances.
Should have Katie come to see us here soon.
Batting number 20, first baseman Henry Wood.
Oh, that's a shot.
Wood tees off on the first pitch he sees. That's going to be a one hopper to the wall. Left fielder Kingston Cole chases it down. And a stand up double starts things off here in the bottom of the second inning. That's going to be trouble if they want to stay in this ballgame. Can't do that too many times.
That was a 52-mile-an-hour curveball, but that's what it's telling me.
Now batting number 17, Tyler Anthony.
Bunt.
Bunt is shown. Holman Blake hustles over for it.
Tommy holds on to it. Thank goodness we're not going to get a bobble, but we're going to have it argued as a bobble.
Tommy Byrne over at first base to cover as Riles Morris came in on the bunt.
Not enough to overturn it, Blue. Not enough to overturn it. You saw the play.
Umpire nods definitively, saying he saw the ball in the glove.
Wind chill that just came in through the door. What do we got batting here, Jim? Go ahead.
Now batting number 19, catcher Tyler Jimenez.
and that answers that. This guy is heading, I believe, senior, heading to Flodar Technical College. Great, great JUCO program.
Those of you not familiar with Flodar, it's the Florence Darlington Technical College, and they do have a great junior college baseball program, a 2-year program that a lot of people are using to move into the transfer portal after 1 or 2 years of playing ball there, getting some experience, getting a lot of at-bats and reps in the field, moving into D1 schools after that. Holden Blake had a nice breaking ball there.
That's another thing I want to talk to Katie about when she shows up is the obviously she's been through the recruiting. Many of these guys on West Ashley have committed to different schools. You know what it looks like out there for high school athletes in this recruiting process.
All in the time. Tommy Byrne second base. He'll take it up over first.
Just sucks it up. Vacuum. Right.
Henry Wood comes in to score. That was the young man that started things off with that booming double out to left. And now it's 6-2.
Now batting number 5, second baseman Reed Lunsford.
This is one fast kid.
Reed Lunsford is a mover and a shaker. Wheels on him. Got the bases empty right now. There's two away here in the bottom of the second inning. Beckham's still enjoying a 4-run lead. And this ball is knocked foul. It'll be out of play over toward the hitting facility and the storage center out there on the right side.
Do not let his petite stature fool you.
You know, Matt, you were talking about the, Maddie Brown's mom having been through the process a few times. And it's a different process now.
It is.
It's a very different recruiting process when it comes to going to a Division I school, especially a Power 5 school. Power 5 being those big conferences like the SEC and the ACC.
Yeah.
Different going to those now because the transfer portal has really opened it up to other students who are already playing college ball, already have experience. And high school kids trying to get into those programs just don't have the same amount of reps. You really got to be a standout to get a D1 offer, to get a D1 scholarship, and especially to get a D1 starting position.
Oh, yeah.
Lunsford reaches on a walk, and that takes us back to the top of the Wildcats lineup.
Now batting, number 11, center fielder Reese Swander.
That transfer portal is really like permanent free agency for the college-age kids. And once you take into account a redshirt season where you can do nothing but work out and get some academics in and practice but not really have to worry about playing, and then you get a year or two at junior college or a D2 or a D3 school, by the time you are ready to go to a D1, you've got 3 years of baseball after high school against stronger arms, stronger bats, faster runners, and these high school kids, unfortunately, are behind the curve when it comes to that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, to everybody, it's a different process, and, it's a different journey for everybody. You just got to, you got to kind of respect the path, that baseball takes you. I mean, there's nothing wrong with going JUCO, D2, D3, D1, NAIA.
Look, I think you're seeing a lot more high schoolers open to those opportunities and those possibilities, and you're seeing those coaches really taking advantage. That was a late throw from Keegan Conroy.
Caught him sleeping there.
Reed Lunsford took off to second, and about a second or two passed before Conroy, I think, really saw what was going on and made the throw down to second. So now runner at second base with two outs, and it's a 1-2 count.
I think he's maybe trying to frame that. He's trying to get the call for
a strike. Spend a little extra time holding it there for the umpire to see.
Yeah, runner on base, you got to do it quick. Your first priority is that runner. And you got to be ready to come up firing with guys on base. So we got Captain Ketchin out here calling something. Maybe we'll see a daylight play or a timing play.
Ball and two strikes now. And Blake sends it in. This one gets behind the umpire.
No, nope, they held him up.
I'm not quite sure what that call was the umpire was making, but it's a 2-2 count.
He thought that might have been strike three.
Yeah. Held up on
and
that
now
one
count
too.
Is full.
He's hungry. It's the kind of hitter I like. Take your hands to the ball. If it's there, keep going. If not, check it.
Both teams without some powerful bats in their lineup tonight. Wildcats without the services. Here we got a
Tommy
ball
gets
on
it.
The ground. Tommy Byrne over to first base. That'll do it. A 4-3 putout ends the inning. Glad to see Tommy involved in all three of those outs in that inning after having that misfortune on that strikeout at the end of the top half. Bounced back, had a put out at first, and then a couple of assists at second base.
That's right.
Start off the third inning. Tyler Anthony is back out on the mound, and coming to the plate for the Bengals will be the number 7 batter in the lineup. Tonight's catcher, Keegan Conroy.
Now batting, number 17, Keegan Conroy.
We're starting to say at the end of the second inning there, both teams without services of some of the strong bats in their lineup. West Ashley without Noah Franklin, and the Bengals tonight without Preston DiNapoli, both players unavailable for tonight's game.
Yeah, a little vacation, a little spring break, early spring break.
Early spring break. Conroy makes
chopper.
Contact,
uh-oh.
Little chopper
uh-oh.
Down to
uh-oh.
Second base.
With
he's going to try to outrun it, and
he
does.
He
nicely done.
In there safely.
As Reed Lunsford really had to come in. He was playing toward the back of the position and had to come in on the infield grass.
Now batting number 5, third baseman Andrew Hoover.
You know, this baseball game is... Man, almost a too late dive back in. Who is that runner? That's Hunter Doyle again.
I would not want to be the next base runner that gets picked off at first base.
And I will tell you, if Hunter Doyle had gotten picked off right there, I think he would have had to have retired.
There we go.
There's a throw. It gets away from Henry Wood. And Doyle gets second base. Doyle in there as a runner for the catcher, running for Keegan Conroy tonight, getting the night off. He's not having to do a whole lot of throwing and fielding tonight, which is nice because Hunter usually is either on the mound or out in the field. And nice to have a rest for the arm tonight. Instead of him playing third base, the man at the plate is taking care of the hot corner, and that's Andrew Hoover. Hoover shows bunt. I wonder if those are new shoes and they're half a size too big, because Hunter just dove back into second base again, and it looks like he's tripping over the dirt when he's trying to dive back in. It just has a funny look to it. like he's having trouble feeling the jump that he's got. Hoover thinks about it, pulls it back, and now it's 1-1. Matt, I got to tell you, I keep looking across these new microphones and microphone flags that are here.
Oh, yeah.
They sure do look sharp. Got Lucy Beckham stickers on. We might need to replace those at some point with one that fits a little bit better, but man, they look sharp. Tyler Anthony comes off the mound to threaten Hunter Doyle, but there's nobody there covering at the base, so there's no throw. And here's the pitch. Bunt is shown. Bunt is left out there.
Now that.
Tyler Jimenez thought about throwing it down and darn near punched Andrew Hoover in the face doing
it. Yeah, that would have been another one of those interference calls. That's what I was just going to say.
This throw was just about to go, and I think that fist ended about the thickness of a frog's mustache away from Andrew's face. Put out at first as Hoover sends one down the first base line. Henry Wood takes care of it himself, but Hunter Doyle reaches safely over third.
Yeah, did the job anyways.
Now batting, number 19, right fielder Gabe Johnson.
Gabe Johnson back up at the plate for the third time. He ended an inning, came back when they... Now here's the ball off the mound.
He's in there.
He's there. Safe at home. Hunter Doyle comes in on the passed ball.
Tack another one on the board.
And the Bengals strike in each inning now. Top of the third. It is 7-2. I know these Bengals were hungry. They had these guys in a preseason scrimmage. And to be frank about it, Matt, they just didn't look good in that scrimmage game.
Well, let's talk about that. Early in the year, West Ashley, a very mature team, had a lot of aces on the mound. You know, that's the time where you know everybody's getting an inning or two.
It is different baseball.
We saw Maddie. We saw their South Carolina commit. We saw several other guys. And I think it was just a little too early for these guys.
And it is a different type of baseball that you're playing in those preseason scrimmages. You're trying not to wear people out. You're trying not to get people hurt. But West Ashley showed the experience. They showed that they'd been around for more than 3 years. They showed that they were confident. And honestly, that confidence is something that has really been a goal for the Bengals this season. You know, the last couple of seasons didn't do a whole lot to instill confidence. And there were a lot of what ifs and maybe not. And these guys just needed to come out here a few times and see that they are good at playing baseball.
They are.
And they've proven it now. And now they're bringing that confidence to tonight's game. It's 7-2 here in the third inning. And Gabe Johnson is the perfect example of that. He's a young man, doesn't have a whole lot of varsity experience, but here he is hacking away, making good choices.
And West Ashley is a 5A.
5A.
Yeah. So we'll be there next year, but they're obviously, you know, always at the top of the list, rankings-wise, one of the better teams in the 5A, South Carolina.
Not sure what that is on the field there, but...
Well,
Coach Andrew Hoover, the Bengals' third base coach, came in to have a word with the catcher, patted him on the back, and asked him almost like he wanted to make sure he was okay. I'm not sure if that was a... He thought the bat might have grazed his mask or something.
Yeah, Coach Taylor's also a catcher himself, so.
He's been down this road.
He knows which ones you might want to double check.
Oh, there's a chopper to third base.
With another piece
Gabe
of work.
Johnson hustling down.
Got
the Wildcats and get the out.
Yeah.
Two away here in the top of the third inning.
Now batting, number 11, center fielder Kevin Fagan.
You know, it's like any sport, really. You want to make sure You know, it's a long season. I think the teams that have a tendency to do better are the ones that, you know, they can just stay hot. They're just that darn good, or they peak at the right time. And got two of those teams on the field here.
You know, it's a, you know, the old saying, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. It's not quite the same level of marathon that you have with a 162-game season at the major league level, but a 30-game season is nothing to slouch at the high school level when you're also having to go to school during the daytime. And most, a lot of these kids are working part-time jobs, and, you know, they're having social lives outside of baseball if they can. And in the meantime, they're still having to worry about taking SATs and ACTs and interviewing for schools and sending letters and emailing coaches and getting the dishes done and the trash taken out and the dog walked.
That's right. You're going to have to do it in college, that's for sure.
Yes, sir, you will. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Get used to it here.
2-2.
Oh.
And Fagan chips one over. His own player's trying to make the out for him.
I think that was like a 64-mile-an-hour Frisbee slider. Did something weird at the end.
Looked like he was fly fishing.
It broke, and then it broke again.
We'll do the 2-2 count over again. Nobody on, two outs here in the top of the third inning. It's 7-2 Lucy Beckham on top of these West Ashley Wildcats. And Fagan will take the count full. Matt, you mentioned Coach Andrew Hoover down there. We haven't talked a whole lot about Andrew yet this year.
Andrew Taylor.
I'm sorry. Andrew Hoover. I'm looking down at my sheet, and I'm seeing one Andrew, and I'm talking about him. Andrew Taylor came to us this year. He was a... he was a pre-McConnell recruit.
Yeah.
Came in just before Coach McConnell got the job.
He did.
And he joined us from Fort Dorchester High School.
Now batting, number 12, first baseman, Riles Morris.
Stay hot.
I'm hearing yells from the first base dugout of Check Eagle. I'm not sure what Check Eagle is, but
hopefully
reminds me a little bit of Omaha.
Are we hearing that from the third base side or the first base
side? That's coming from the first base side.
Check Eagle.
Check Eagle. There's also a there's also a high-pitched Waller. Maybe a Warble. Not sure what that is. I think that's the Carolina Bengal. Oh, here we go. They're doing the old hand over the mouth.
I see. You did that very well.
Oh, thank you. I've been working on that. There we go. Getting it warmed up again over at the first base dugout.
Okay.
Manny Menez blocks one up. Ball and two strikes now on Morris.
Seems to be a rally cry, maybe.
You know, rally cry, mating call? I'm not sure what that is.
But going back to Coach Taylor, yeah, he's come in here and took the kids through the fall, down in prospects. You know, he knows the game. I'd like to call him a player's coach, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, he's never going to get too high. He's never going to get too low. At times he'll be aggressive. At times he's going to be conservative.
He's found his role over there at the third base coach's box. He's over there most of the time. Every once in a while, BJ goes out there and takes care of it. But for the most part, that's Andrew's box.
Yeah.
And there he is jumping out of the way. There's those dance lessons coming in handy again for the team.
There's those shots that Riles will give you. If you're not going to pitch him where he likes it, they'll just send it the other way.
We've got to do some research on Riles and find out what his exit velo is right now.
Oh, I'll tell you, that was 75. Nope.
I'd be curious to see what he's done in some of his showcases in summer ball. And
he's up on it. I mean,
I thought it was almost behind him. Was that actually behind him?
No, that just ran inside. Showcase ball and this is completely different. I mean, you know you're going up there to take your daddy hacks.
Yep, that's you're getting freebies. They're going to be down the middle every time. But it's still a neat thing to see
is
what can you do with a baseball bat?
Yeah, I think a lot of the guys on this team you're going to see probably have an exit velo between 90 and 100. To get the ball out of this field, I would say left center, you got to be over 100 miles an hour with your exit velo at the right angle. It's not as shallow as it looks. I think that's about right where the B is in the Bengals is about 383.
Ryle Morris just followed another one off. Kevin Fagan made his way to second on the pitch before that, or the stolen base.
We've seen this field does not let balls leak.
No, this the one hop, two hop to the fence is a common thing. These balls just don't go over well. Although, you know, you got to give some love to the junior varsity team. They actually have put one over in gameplay. They were the first to put one over in real game conditions.
There's a shot. There's one to the grass.
Left field.
We're going to have a play at the
plate.
No, we're not.
And Kevin Fagan across the plate. Ryles Morris with the RBI single. It's 8-2. Lucy Beckham. That's baseball in Mount Pleasant on a Thursday night here at
The Beck. You know, Jim, I thought of another name. Okay.
Now batting. Number two. Shortstop. Karen,
action. Matt, I interrupted you. What were you saying there, bud?
No, outside of this window, and around the complex, the concourse, we all have sort of adopted the name The Beck.
The Beck.
But I think right up here where we sit has a different feel than out there.
What's up here, Matt?
Where we're sitting, this press box.
What are we thinking about for this up here?
The clubhouse.
Clubhouse.
This is the clubhouse.
I might have to chew on that a little bit.
It sounds a little, I think more like a box.
No, I don't want to sit in the box. That sounds like a penalty box.
Honestly, I feel more like it's the chicken coop. And a pickoff attempt over to first has Ryles Morris diving back into the base that he painted and placed at the beginning of this game. Now 2-0 on catching.
Is a chicken coop square?
Chicken coop can be whatever you need it to be.
Because this place is not square.
Chicken coop can be whatever you need it to be, Matt.
And it's not level. If I get out of this chair.
Well, let's face it.
It's heading left.
Buddy, we've laid some eggs up here. We have laid some eggs up here on these microphones. 2-1. Here's a short, soft chopper back to the mound.
I bet Perrin would like to get that one.
And that comebacker will do it. So Ryles Morris gets left at the bases. Perrin catching, having a word with Vic Major down there on the first baseline. He's getting a pat on the back for him. And we'll switch and go to the bottom of the third. It is 8-2. Bengals on top.
Right
there, Coleman Blake, a little bit of a break to it, 68 miles an hour, and he gets a strike on Matty Brown. Blake steps off. He's going to think about it for a second. Doesn't like what he's getting from Keegan Conroy on the sign. He's going to ask for something new, so he'll rotate it. And he's got one he likes. Oh, nice off-speed pitch. He drops a couple miles an hour and gets Matty Brown to swing away. 0-2.
Let's see if we'll see these synchronized outfielders. Do we get it?
Nope. Not on that pitch.
Not on that one. On
that one. That one's away from Keegan, and Coach Vic Major hops out of the dugout, and he'll shag that ball. Ball and two strikes now as Brown waits on it. Holman in the windup. Nods his approval to that sign. Kicks, delivers. This ball is in the air. Perrin Ketchum drops back for it.
Oh, what a catch.
What a catch! What a catch! Holy cow! Perrin Ketchum on the run.
Fully
reaches back and lays out. And I think he got a hug from Kingston Cole, man. Holy cow!
Yeah, that's a football play right there.
That right there is why he's going to Wofford on a football scholarship. That man chased it down.
That definitely was supposed to get down.
Now here's the third baseman, David Stallworth.
Oh! Takes one in the knee. It's going to hurt a little
bit. Stallworth was showing bunt. That pitch came well inside. He wore it on the leg.
Kind of that funny bump.
Yeah,
but
that's
not really funny.
There's not a whole lot of padding there. And we're going to have a couple of the coaches come out and have a word with him, make sure that that young man is all right. That's their third baseman. He's the same one that had that twist in his ankle as he made the jog over to try to grab that ball that scooted down the third base line two innings ago. He's done a lot of walking it off tonight, and he's going to need to again. That one's on the same knee as that ankle was before. So Zach Russell will be the man with the bat in his hand here.
Zach is the this is the University of South Carolina commit.
Now batting number 13, shortstop Zach Russell.
When he pitches, he's up there in velo in the state of South Carolina. I think he's 91 to 93.
Well, we certainly don't want to have that tonight. Now he shows bunt, draws it back, and it's called strike one.
Yeah, we've got some film on this guy. I think when Preston was pitching last time, he laid one down. Beautifully executed. If you remember, right after that, we had the steal of home.
We did indeed. Now we've got a toss over first base. Matt, I keep looking out there to that left field side, back there behind Kingston Cole. That I still can't figure out what that is. That yellowish golden shock of hair back there looks like.
It's
just creeping up.
Kind of like the Uniballer.
Almost the same color as the fence topper out there. Just not quite as yellow, but right there in that same color wheel.
You know what would go great out there, Jim?
I have no idea.
A camera.
Ooh, if we had a camera, Matt, we could zoom right in there and see what's going on.
We sure could. Yeah. But that's a beautiful spot for spectators. If we can build a deck out there.
Oh, that
nice little porch.
Listen, yeah, I've seen fire and I've seen rain, but I've never seen a deck in left field like that one's called before.
Yeah, maybe a couple tree stands out there somewhere.
Ball and two strikes here, one on, one out. That young man that's on first base reached the toughest way possible with a shot to the knee. Now Holman Blake has switched to the stretch, and he comes inside.
Nice pitch.
And it's
just,
2-2.
Just ran inside a little too much.
Yeah, that one he was trying to keep it on the inside edge of the plate, but I think that one got a little more belt buckle than he wanted.
Maybe like to see a little change up away. Might get him.
Ooh. Now he comes outside and runs the count full.
That's a fastball away at 80 miles an hour.
Holman doesn't throw up in the 90s, but he's pretty good about being able to put the ball where he wants it. He can move it to both sides of the plate, and he doesn't get real wild, especially on a night like this where he seems to really be feeling things.
He does. He does. He seems settled. He's not in his head. He's just out there doing the job. It's what you got to do. Just take a deep breath, one pitch at a time.
Russell knocks one foul over to his head coach at the third base box, and the count stays full. Blake comes set. And a strikeout. Let's see that dance.
Let's see the dance.
Wait a minute. There it is. There it is.
Yeah, they
Kevin
got a dance.
Kevin Fagan and Kingston Cole, they got something lined up there.
We're going to have to ask them about that after the game.
Now batting left fielder number 3, Tate Westerville.
They got a little celebration thing going on over there. And they should when you got Holman throwing strikes like this. That ball just nicely tucked in. And Keegan Conroy doing a good job behind the plate. He's not the usual starter behind the dish, but he's doing a good job of it tonight. Throwing signs like a gang member there, and Holman gets one he likes. 1-1's your count now. 8-2 is your score. Lucy Beckham on top. They've scored in each of the 3 innings they've played so far. 4 in the first, 2 in the second, 2 in the third. Wildcats have put one up in the first and one in the second, and they've been held scoreless here in the third inning so far. There's one on and 2 away. As Holman tries to keep it this way with the goose egg in the bottom half of the frame. Westervelt waits on it. Off-speed pitch hits 66 miles an hour and falls just a little low for the umpire's taste. It's 3-1. Henry Wood, big first baseman over there on deck. He had a double the last time, a one-hopper out to the fence, so it'd be nice to have him not come to the plate with runners on. But unfortunately, that's going to be the case as Blake issues a walk and Henry Wood comes up with 2 on. That big bat trying to break things open here for Wildcats. West Ashley trailing by 6. They are the home team in this contest. Tonight's game was supposed to be played at West Ashley High School tomorrow night, but the threat of heavy rain over tomorrow afternoon and evening and into Saturday morning has changed many baseball plans as well as canceled other outdoor events around the area. And Blake comes right after him.
You can hear that leather snap right up here.
He's not afraid to throw the heater to him on that first pitch, and it's a 79 mile an hour fastball for strike 1.
Keegan does a great job of catching that ball firm and making 79 sound like it's 85.
Now batting number 20, first baseman Henry Wood.
We've missed a couple on the announcements tonight, but not too bad.
What do you mean? What did we miss?
I missed one completely, and I've been late on about 2 or 3.
There we go. Hear that snap again at 80.
Ball and 2 strikes now on Henry Wood. This would be a great place for Holman to get a strikeout. Leave the mound after 3 innings with
I'm going
confidence.
With a 66 mile an hour curve. 12-6. Dead center.
I have a feeling he's going to run inside on him like a cat in the rain. What you got there, Holman? Blake, what you going to throw? He thinks about it, steps off, and now he's ready. From the stretch, here's the kick, here's the pitch. It's up high. 2-2.
This is not off-speed left.
Dave Schrock behind me calling the off-speed. Here's the pitch. Wood thought about it, caught his swing halfway, and now the count is full on him. Dave Schrock called off speed. Of course, Dave also said he had the winning Powerball ticket last night.
He did until he didn't.
They started pulling those numbers and it all went to heck.
That's right. Until that moment.
Until that very moment. And a full count walk for the big first baseman. Loads the bases. That's 2 walks in a row, and that's going to have Coach Kyle Statz head out of the dugout, and he'll come have a word. Kyle Statz, the pitching coach, one of the coaches up there at Asteri Sports Performance that I mentioned earlier, specializes in working on the hill, and we'll have both teams take a little meeting while we talk about the One Beckham Foundation. Matt, I know that we talk about this all the time, but we're going to keep talking about it until we raise $300,000 a year to help fund the programs and activities of Lucy Beckham High School. Want to know how to help?
Thomas Howe. Show your support for Beckham Academics, Arts, and Athletics by joining the One Beckham Foundation. Help them reach their $300,000 goal to fund the vital programs for the students. Visit the One Beckham Foundation, onebeckhamfoundation.com to join or become a corporate sponsor.
You're going to have to pause right there, Jim. You missed another one.
Indeed, I did.
Now batting, number 15, Corey Brain.
So Corey Brain makes an appearance back into the game. He was the starting pitcher, and he was batting in the 7 hole. Tyler Anthony came in and hit for him when he was replacing him on the mound, and now Brain back in.
Is that a ball?
I believe it's a 1-1 count on him now. Now 2-1.
Cool 60 degrees tonight. Wind blowing out towards right center.
Cool is not even the right word for it. It's almost chilly. This ball up the middle. That thing gets through. 1-1 scores. Here's a second run. That one got past Holman. That one got past Perrin and all the way out to center field. That ball had a funny bounce over the mound and it just couldn't get knocked down. Perrin Ketchum came way over to his left trying to make that play. He would have had the easy out right there at second base. And instead, it's 8-4 here in the third inning. So no luck as we try to keep the run off the board.
This is where the mental part of the game can get to
you. Number 19, catcher Tyler Jimenez.
It can get the better of you if you don't. There we go. Settle in.
First pitch strike. Kind of a pattern here for Holman Blake. He likes to throw that first pitch and get ahead of him. Would have been a sweet place for a strikeout in that last one, but unfortunately.
Just got to settle a little bit, breathe through the eyelids.
You know what, that last hit, I don't think there's another way. I've been trying to sit here and think of a way to describe it. That's one that's just the baseball gods.
Yeah.
That's one where the baseball gods say we're going to let this one go through. No real error on the play.
No,
it wasn't a hard hit ball. It's just the baseball gods reaching down, putting one through to the outfield. And
just hit hard enough.
Keeping the game interesting.
Center's got to come get it. You never know. I didn't see where Perrin was playing, but that's a ball up the middle. Unless you're holding the runner. Either the second baseman or the shortstop's holding the runner there, then it's going to be difficult to get all the way up the middle.
Oh, a nice looking pitch, not getting the call. It's 3-1 now.
But I can tell you this, if anybody could get up the middle, it'd be Perrin.
Holman Blake's thrown 73. He's faced 16 batters so far this evening.
Tops out 81 right there.
Another batter goes to a full count with him. That's about 4 batters in a row, I believe, that have been quality at-bats for West Ashley as they've had full counts in each of them. Now a foul ball.
Another 81 mile an hour pitch right there for Holman. Seems like he's peaking. He's getting into it. The blood's pumping.
Wildcats catcher steps out of the box for a minute, takes a little walk around. Gets himself ready again.
He's just going to have to locate this one. I don't think he's going to bring the off speed. He's going to have to locate.
And that ball is another walk. That's at least 3 walks here in this inning. And Holman glances over to the first base dugout to see if there's a coach coming to get him. There is not.
No Uber.
Thank you.
There we go. Got another one.
Now batting. Now batting number 5, Reed Lunster.
Hand off.
See? Gosh, Dave, you gotta remember to turn it off.
If that's the worst thing that happens to us, we'll be fine. A little bit of field noise.
Yeah.
Lunsford fouls one off. The Wildcats have put a runner on for the catcher. The young man out there is...
You see the West Ashley set up there.
We'll take a look at it in just a second. The young man out there is Tyler Burnett running at first base.
Here's Reed Lunsford again. Pesky little sucker. Oop. That one there.
West Ashley working the iPad and camera down there at the backstop netting. Two as Blake misses very wide. Bases are full here. Two outs in the bottom of the third inning. Bengals still on top. They've doubled up the Wildcats so far. It's 8-4 now. And Blake delivers. This ball is fouled back. Count stays the same at 2-2. We're going to go back and check on the B team. See what that game looks like. B team still playing baseball at 8 o'clock tonight. They're 2 hours into their game. They're in the top of the sixth. Still leading. It's 12-9 over there at Park West. And a strikeout for Holman Blake. The Wildcats strand three. The Bengals stay on top, but the Wildcats add two to their sum. It is 8-4 here as we play Thursday night baseball in Mount Pleasant at
the Beck.
Pitching for West Ashley, number 13, Zach Russell.
Well,
so West Ashley has their third pitcher of the evening coming in now. Zach Russell takes over. He was playing shortstop before, so the boys in white will have another shortstop.
Now batting, number 9.
Hank Epley leading things off as he sees this new Wildcat pitcher, and the Wildcat throws a little bit wild.
At 90.
But he's hitting the 90 mark. He's in the Niners. just grabbed the outside corner of the...
That just sounds different than anything we've seen here.
And was that 50? No, that was the throwback. That had to be the throwback.
That was not even 90 again.
Three pitches in a row, all at 90 miles an hour. All three of them on the outer edge or beyond. And now it's 2-1 on the designated hitter. Hank Effley having a night off from squatting behind the plate. Gives a ball up the middle. This one is thrown wild. That is the shortstop throwing that. I'm not sure who that is. What is it?
Corey Brain.
That's Corey Brain. Corey Brain, the starting pitcher, came back in as a batter in the last inning, and now he's out there at shortstop.
Now batting, number 6, left fielder, Kingston Cole.
Attempt over there to first base, and Zach Russell doesn't like the fact that Hank Epley is hanging out there on the bases. And Kingston Cole trying to deal with it. Kingston just on fire as of late, just keeps knocking that baseball around, and he hits one, this time foul, over the first base side of the grandstands.
Yeah, I think Hank got a piece of an 80-mile-an-hour, if it was off a curve or change.
A bit of dampness in the air. It says 60 on the thermometer, but it does not feel 60 degrees. It feels chilly out here. You can see the mist in the air out around some of the moth lights in right field especially. You can see the effects of it as some of these fans out here are tucked up under blankets and have heavier jackets on this evening. Does not seem to be affecting Kingston Cole, who gives the wiggle. He always has a wiggle for the fans there between each pitch. Long fingernails keep Hank Effley alive as he dives back into first on another pickoff. And Kingston on a 2-2 count steps into the box. Russell with the pitch, goes to the outside edge, can't get it, and now the count is full. Dave Schrock right behind me. Pushing buttons on three different machines tonight. One of them the iPhone for the game changer. Another one keeping the field scoreboard working. And of course, reaching behind and hitting the button for the field mic whenever we can. Sometimes on, sometimes off. Sometimes not off when it should be off. It doesn't matter.
Huh?
We get paid the same way.
What do you say? Do we have two people out there in left field here?
Hang on, let's get a look at that. We got a full count here on Kingston. And he fouls one back. That's going to be in Jimenez's face mask.
We have the binoculars, Jim. You come prepared.
Well, you know.
I thought I had all the toys.
Safety and security first here, Matt. Let's take a look at what kind of interloping we have out there in left field.
You know, that space out there is public property. Just one.
There are two heads out there.
Yes.
Just peeking over the outfield fence. Another toss over to first base. Kingston Kolb on pitch number 9, I think, here now. Have this at bat. Oh, and as he comes around, that gets him on the shoulder, it looked like. That one, I think, got him on the shoulder.
Are they calling that a foul ball?
Is that going to be a foul, or is that going to be a hit batsman?
On the hand.
The call on the field is a foul ball, saying that it got the bat and the hand, the handle and the hand on Kingston. Now he's having the trainer looking at his left hand. He walked off and had to give the bat up. And he'll take a look at this to see how it looks. That was a 90 mile an hour pitch that he grabbed out of the air with the backside of his left hand.
Let's remind everybody how fast that is.
Well, Matt, highway speeds are 60 miles an hour. 90 is a 60, and then another half of that. Now, it doesn't have quite the same mass as a vehicle. But it's definitely not something you want to jump in front of and get hit by on purpose. Another pickoff attempt over to first base, and Henry Wood gets a tag down on a guy who's already reaching the back over to first. Now here's the pickoff pitch. Kingston Cole puts one into left field.
That might die. Yeah.
It touches the ground, and it's a base hit on Kingston Cole. So way to fight back from that one.
89.
And an 89 mile an hour pitch is taken to shallow left for a base hit.
And Jim, we just had our guest arrive.
Outstanding. I'm gonna.
Elijah.
Yep.
Now batting number 3, second baseman Tommy Byrne.
Get a little video here.
There's a lot going on here, Katie.
Yeah, man.
We do.
This is a system.
Matt, up here in the booth, just sitting to my right between us, we have Miss Katie Brown.
We do. Katie is a very good friend of ours and known her many, many years.
Yes, we have.
Tommy Byrne shows bun.
Katie is quite the baseball mom. How many boys you have that have come through the high school and college programs now?
Three boys. Craig actually played club baseball at Carolina, and then he coached. Now he's in podiatry school. Bryce, he's down there. He played for College of Charleston. He pitched. Yep. He's in chiropractic school now.
Yeah.
And then Maddie, he's going to North Greenville for pitching next year.
Optometrist.
I wish. More like a plastic surgeon. That'd be good.
There you go.
But yeah, we've had a lot of ups and downs with things. Baseball's a game of failure for sure.
It is. We were actually just talking about that before you came up here, Katie. And I think it was Maddie's last at bat, that ball that should have dropped in that Perrin got to.
Wow,
and
that was a great catch.
You know, it seemed like they were going to get on a little run there.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and then we were watching Holman, who was pitching for us on the mound, probably trying to just get through that inning.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I just said, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where that mental part of the game, you know, you got to take control of it.
For sure. When that adversity hits, you got to be strong enough to bounce back quickly in this game, you know, especially after a strikeout, anything like that. Go back to the dugout and you let it stew.
Speaking of strikeouts, Tommy Byrne retired on strikes there after several bunt attempts, and then he watches strike number 3, so that'll bring Keegan Conroy to the plate.
Now batting number 17, Keegan Conroy.
How's your sound, Katie? Can you hear us?
I can hear you. No, it's great.
Good.
Katie, I guess you've been down the road that a lot of these parents that are listening and some of the ones that are here in the stands tonight have not, which is getting young high school baseball players to develop into college baseball players, what it takes to get them into school, what it takes to get them through school, importantly, as student athletes, and have them be successful both in and out of the classroom. What kind of tips and secrets do you have at any point in that sequence? Getting
especially
them in, keeping them in, and most importantly, getting them out when they have earned their degrees.
Well, yeah. I would say that probably when it comes to baseball especially, a lot of times they need to know that they need to have a good mental program for themselves in order, because once you get to college, it's a whole different thing.
And you would know for sure.
Oh yeah, it's like these guys are everything is even once you get to college. If you're a superstar in high school,
you're just another guy.
That's right. So
now batting number 5, third baseman Andrew Hoon.
So what I mainly do is, you know, I like to get kids at a young age so they learn to empower their minds and not let adversity distract them. And, you know, more of a you versus you mentality. Right. Social media has really messed up, you know, a lot for these kids because they compare themselves to each other so much.
Yeah. And it's so easy to get that comparison because you can go on TikTok, you can go on YouTube, which if you're not going on YouTube to watch Lucy Beckham baseball, there's a lot of other videos out there I've heard. I've never looked at any of the others other than Lucy Beckham. But there's so much out there that's just immediately accessible. Am I as fast as this guy? Am I as strong as this guy? Why am I not getting the recruiting? Why am I not getting the offers or the looks?
Right.
And baseball on the field, just as much as in the training rooms and in the film rooms and in the off season, is so much a mental game. It's not just about the physical prowess of the player.
For sure.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things... smart play.
Here's the play at the plate coming up here in just a second. No throw.
I don't think I don't think they were expecting the throw out of second.
Hank Epley stole third. The throw was drawn down to second, and that throw got away just in the shallow center field, but enough.
It was a beautiful throw. Threw it on the money. That's your job. Throw it to the bag.
9-4 is your score now. I'm sorry so much, Katie, that we were talking and I saw baseball.
No, it's
Katie,
exciting.
This is what we do. We got to jump in and out. He's got to announce. I got buttons to push, music to play. These guys, we want country, we want hip hop.
Listen, I raised 3 boys in a house that we played 4-year baseball, so I can handle this. There's I can promise you that.
Yeah, we 20 seconds. Shiny.
If we can get you anything, you let us know. We'll make you comfortable. You're welcome to stay as long as you can. Last week we had... was it last week or was it this week?
This week. Rob Fowler.
Rob Fowler came in. He threw out the first pitch.
Oh, that's awesome.
And then he came up here, supposed to do an inning just with Jim. And he ended up calling the whole game.
Oh, my gosh. That's
hilarious. Yeah, and it was...
he's a nice guy.
Rob's fantastic. And here's Andrew Hoover going down on strikes. So the Bengals end up having the side struck out. Tommy Byrne, Keegan Conroy, and Andrew Hoover all going down. And it's... 9-4 as we go into the top of the bottom of the fourth inning.
Yeah.
I'm keeping
what do we want to play now? I don't know what to play for these guys. Pump up the jam. Let's play Pump Up the Jam. I don't know why not.
Holy cow, you're going old school.
You're playing some good music, though. Yeah. We were talking about that down there.
So, Matty Brown is heading to Flodar.
No.
No, I'm sorry. North Greenville.
Yeah, the whole side is loaded. Don't worry.
Matty Brown. This is not your first time sending one of your babies off to foreign lands to go play baseball.
And we'll be empty nesters next year. I'm not going to lie. I'm a little excited.
Are you guys going to get an RV and travel?
We're going to travel a lot, I think. I've been getting a lot busier lately. So I plan to travel around doing some more group things
because
I really enjoy that. That's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it definitely is. And we, I sat in with Coach McConnell. I don't know if this team looks different to you than the teams you've seen.
They're doing really well.
I mean, I think we have our own field. How does the field look better?
Amazing.
Yeah.
Even Bryce.
Matt, you're fishing for compliments over here, Matt. Yeah. You're fishing.
No, we just have, you know.
No, my son Bryce played summer ball here a lot, you know, and through the years. And
there was a lot of lumps in the field.
Oh, yeah. It looks amazing.
This thing got tore up, but it's nice that they finally have their own field. They're not out at Shipyard.
Yeah.
They brought in a new head coach. I think he's coached the Diamond Devils.
Oh, that's great.
Coach McConnell.
Actually, David Beckley told me about him.
Yeah.
Said he was very good.
Now pitching for Lucy Beckham, number 24, Sawyer Minton.
And he runs his practices like what I would expect to see in a college. I mean, he's got the turtle up, guys are hitting, he's got both coaches hitting fungos.
There's no downtime. There's no downtime.
That makes such a difference. No.
Everything's on a schedule.
Just keeping their
organization, having a plan.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Now batting, number 11, center fielder Reese Swander.
So Jim has many voices right here.
So, Katie, let me ask you. We talked a little bit about how baseball is a mental game. What do you see as the number one place or the number one thing that hangs up players from a mental standpoint, from a concentration or focus or distraction standpoint? What is it that seems to keep the players from doing or becoming everything that they can be and realizing their full potential? What stands in their way?
You know, fear of failure is a big one, and they just lose their confidence. I work with so many kids that are going through a slump, and, you know, they get freaked out about it. They get knocked down in the lineup, you know, and they think they'll never get it back again.
Yeah.
And so it's one of those things where you just have to build their confidence back up. I use, like...
Oh! Shot at the middle. That one almost killed Sawyer Minton. That's a mental problem if you have...
Yes, it is.
If you have a dead pitcher, we can't have that.
No.
So. Real quick, while we're...
And here's your son.
There he is.
While we're waiting for Matty Brown to step into the box.
Does he have any special music?
No.
What's it?
You know what? I don't
know. Now batting, number 2, right fielder Matty Brown.
I don't want to mess with him. I play some Taylor Swift, but I love Taylor Swift. I didn't think I would like Taylor Swift, my daughter, and I got a video I'll show you. My daughter and my wife went to live in Pittsburgh, and I have a new appreciation for the performer.
Yeah.
Rather than just the music and the pop, but the performance.
For sure.
Over the top. But yeah, so go ahead.
Matty Brown at the plate. Mama Brown, not of barbecue fame. Those of you who have been around Mount Pleasant for a few years remember Mama Brown's barbecue. But this is not the same one. This is Miss Katie Brown watching her baby boy playing baseball here. He's the man in the purple helmet at the plate, and he's got a 1-1 count on him. Nobody's out here in the bottom of the fourth inning, and he's got a runner at first.
Just ice in his veins. The kid just plays baseball. Looks so comfortable.
Real quick, while we have Sawyer Minton on the field as the relief pitcher, let's take a look back at Holman Blake as well. Holman threw 82 pitches, 43 of them for strikes. At 3 innings, had 4 runs on 3 hits. All 4 of those runs were earned. And he was even with 4 strikeouts and 4 walks in his evening of work. Now 3-1 on Matty Brown.
Katie, what about, you saw Maddie's first hit, huh?
Yes, I did.
This park just holds the ball and won't let it go.
I was hoping the wind would blow a little bit.
The wind here tends to go from left to right. Gets a little bit of help out in right field, but that's not where he was. He was working on the left side.
He was dead center. And
the ball just gets pushed into the deep gap back there by the word Bengals.
Yeah. Our center fielder, Kevin, turned and I was reading his body language. I thought he gave up on it. Like, he was getting ready to look at it over his head. And, you know, he was gone. But next thing you know, it's at his feet. So.
Full count, payoff pitch. Sawyer Minton gets Matty Brown swinging. And here's the throw down to second.
He's safe.
Reese Swander safe into second on the stolen bag. He's one away here.
He'll want a chance to get that one back, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. He's good about bouncing back.
Yeah. What's his routine like after a strikeout like that? Is he, leave me alone for a minute or two, let me get it out?
No, he just knows that he can get back into it.
David Stallworth.
Doesn't let it fester.
Yeah.
A lot of kids do. Yeah. And you know, that affects you. If you go up to bat, the hitting's hard.
It is.
You know, my husband's a coach too. He played for College of Charleston as well. And hitting's hard. And when you go up there tense, thinking you're going to strike out, you probably are going to strike out.
Right.
We're here in the booth talking with Miss Katie Brown, legendary Low Country baseball mom, and mother of West Ashley right fielder Matty Brown, who you just saw at the plate just a few moments ago. And Katie Brown has... Let's make sure we plug your business. It's a... Go ahead.
Mental prep.
Mental prep, right?
It's called Mental Prep 4. Yes, I do sports inner mind work. So, I mean, it is some hypnotherapy, but it's also, it's not weird hypnotherapy. Okay.
It's beautiful.
It's you know, these kids, they need some calming of the mind. And now I do differently with yips. You got to get a little more aggressive with yips.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What's the difference between just being in a slump, being down, and the yips?
The yips, that is definitely a subconscious thing that does not allow the body to do what you're trying to. Oh, yeah.
It's a block.
It is the craziest thing I've ever seen. And I've had probably about 20 kids with the yips, and I've helped out 19 of them. One of them I could not.
2-1's your count here at the bottom of the fourth inning. One on, one out. 9-4 is the score. The Bengals are on top of the Wildcats. Katie Brown talking about the yips and how 19 out of 20 kids.
Oh, that ball's fair. That's in play.
That's going to bring one around. Reese Swander takes third and comes in standing to the plate. It's a stand-up double for Stallworth.
It's a nice little shot down the line. Yeah.
Score now 9-5. Not just a Dolly Parton song.
Not sure if you can see, but one of your clients is up there, probably in left center field, just beyond the yellow. Yeah, that's. Yeah.
Now batting number 13, pitcher Zach Russell.
I think they're out there surveying to put a deck or something, a porch. He's not allowed to be here, so.
I gotcha.
Katie, I'm sure that there's no typical, but when you see somebody who comes in and says, I'm just not hitting the ball, I'm not seeing it, I feel like I'm just, nothing's going right for me, what kind of an approach do you take? What can a player, or what can a parent or a family expect when you take on one of these young men as a client? And how long does it usually take to say, okay, we're seeing some progress, we're making some differences, and performance-wise, we're getting back to where we should be and seeing a positive result? What's that look like?
Okay. Usually, we talk about the physical, emotional, and mental issues, and then we replace it with good things that they want to see, feel, do, and be. I don't like talking about the bad stuff.
This ball is a mile high in shallow left field. Kingston Cole comes, grabs, spins, and it's an out. And David Stallworth is going to have to camp out at second base a little longer. He had no opportunity to advance with a sacrifice there. And so there's two away here in the bottom of the fourth inning.
It's been a slow game.
Yeah. Well,
now batting number 3, left fielder Tate Westervelt.
Started off real fast. These guys came out, Lucy Beckham came out swinging.
They did.
Looked pretty impressive. And but we were up here talking before you came up here, you know, with West Ashley, they're always, you know, a contender in the state, 5A. And
yeah.
I mean, you can tell by the roster how many guys are going to college. How many of the guys on this team do you end up spending time with for either at your house, sleeping over,
right,
or... So, working on through the mental part of the game.
So it's funny, you know, they I always give them little tips. I've gone in there, done group sessions during school with them, and different things like that. They'll just call me and ask me, hey, can you do this?
This ball is on a rope out to left field. Kingston Cole running. That thing hits the wall. Stallworth comes around. It's going to be a play at second. Westervelt is in safety. Two doubles in a row as Westervelt trades places with Zach Russell. And it's 9-6. West Ashley creeping on the fucking Bengals here in the fourth inning.
Mm. So you were saying you go in there, you'll just give them little tips.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Now that number 20, first baseman Henry Hood.
Katie, getting back to that last question that I asked you, how long would you say it takes to really see some results with some of these guys that come in, again, not feeling it, having that slump, if you will?
So I've had kids listen to a recording that I made for them in one night, and they went from batting 0-17 to being 4-for-4 with 2 home runs the next night. I know that sounds crazy. That's not usual. But that was a player from ECU who couldn't believe it because he was in such a slump. And then we have but most of the time, I would say 6 to 7 days, you start seeing results.
Yeah.
You know, you got to figure out their self-talk. Teach them some deep breathing techniques. Teach them some type of thing to think about. You know, hitting is probably the hardest.
Right.
So a pre in the box routine, right. Something like that, and you know, just to get their mind off of whatever it is that's swirling in their head.
Right. And you know, we see these things with athletes. You hear about athletes all the time, but you see it in all kinds of things. The Navy SEALs and the Special Operations are using deep breathing and visualization.
It's called combat breathing.
The square breathing, mm-hmm. four counts.
Mm-hmm.
You see people in all kinds of professions using it. They preach it to business leaders now, and there's a bunch of different stuff that you see for people who just want to realize a better level of themselves and a better performance in whatever that arena is. Sawyer Minton coming set. And a ball on the ground. Heron catching at the shortstop takes it. This is going across the diamond. And Minton gets himself out of trouble.
Woo! Get that out of that one.
9-6 is the score as we head to the fifth.
And this one's
Lucy good. Beckham on top here with Thursday Night Baseball at the Beck. Katie, we were just saying the deep breathing and these visualization techniques. I can tell you, Coach B.J. McConnell, he's a big believer in actualization, self-actualization, and being able to put yourself in a situation mentally before you ever get there. He puts it out to his team to visualize those
things. The night
things.
Before, when you go to bed.
See yourself making the catch. See yourself making the hit.
Well, they've done studies, and if you can do that over and over and over again in your head, it's like you are doing it physically. And, you know, you just put that into place, planting that seed. And let me tell you, a lot of these tools that they use, conscious and subconscious, they take it into life also. It's not just things for baseball and for sports. It's great. And for school. I mean, I work with a lot of kids for test-taking anxiety, too. And but this carries over. It carries over to life and going into interviews, going into, you know, different things like that. You know, empowerment. That's my whole passion, is making sure that these kids are empowered enough naturally to handle any type of adversity they face. Because they're going to be our future someday.
like it or not.
Like it or not. So I want them to be powerful because they're going to take care of us someday.
So these young men, and I say young men because we're talking about baseball and we have two all-male teams here, but I'm sure that you know, some of the athletes, some of the clients that you've seen over the years are female as well. But these young men that we have here, and I'm going to have to pause this question for one moment.
Now batting, number 19, Gabe Johnson.
He's the first varsity guy. He's gotten a bat on the ball twice tonight.
These young men that we have that come to see you, would you say that most of the come of their own free will, or is it their parents pushing them that direction? And do you have any that come in skeptical, saying, you know, this is a bunch of hooey, I'm just, you know, I just need to hit the gym, I just need to see some more pitches in the cage, whatever it is. What kind of reaction do you have? And if you do have somebody who's resistant, how do you overcome that?
I won't take them if they don't think that it can work for them, because it won't work for them if they don't want to come.
Right.
I don't want the parents to waste their time or their money on it. So I always say to the parent, did you tell them to do this, or did they find out from somebody else? It's usually word of mouth from another player.
Mm-hmm.
That's what always happens.
Ooh, Gabe Johnson just takes a dancing step out of the way of that one. Left foot back, got two steps right.
Almost took a swing at it with a holy crap.
That would have been a swing. Defensive swing. And there's a swing there, and quickly there's one away. We'll head to the top of the lineup here as Kevin Fagan strides to the box.
Now batting, number 11, center fielder, Kevin Fagan.
So when you have those people that come in and you know, you ask them, why are you here? You know, are you here on your own? You know, did you force your kid to come here? Those types of questions. Do you ever have any that are still apprehensive, that are still a little, I'm willing to try it, I don't know, I'll try anything. Do you ever have that kind of reaction?
I have a lot. I've tried everything else. This is my last resort. I hope it works. And it usually does. So, and then they'll tell me, I wish this would have been my first resort.
Right. You should have been here sooner.
Right.
Yeah. And, you know, with baseball and golf are two of the biggest sports. I have a lot of gymnasts and a lot of, ice skaters, too. Mm. That is a very scary sport. I know that sounds crazy, but
no, I mean,
they're terrified, especially when it's a pairing, and they put all of their trust in their partner that throws them up in the air. So
yeah, you're getting thrown up in the air. Yeah. You're spinning it, 100 revolutions a minute, and you're on a slab of hard ice. It's cold. You've got razor blades on your feet.
Yeah,
there's a lot that can go wrong there, Katie.
Exactly.
If you're wondering what we're talking about, we've got Katie Brown up here in the booth with us tonight. Kevin Fagan goes down swinging. That's two strikeouts in a row for Mr. Zach Russell on the mound. If you're wondering what we're talking about, Katie Russell talking to us.
And Katie Brown.
I'm sorry, Katie Russell. I'm looking at Zach Russell talking to Katie Brown. And I'm announcing Riles Morris. Now batting number 12.
Riles Morris.
We're talking to Katie Brown. Excuse me.
You're pushing buttons in your head.
I'm pushing everything over here. Katie is the owner of Mental Prep 4, a company that specializes in helping players, athletes of all kinds, become their best selves from a mental and emotional standpoint. Miles Moore is trying to become his best player, and he gets that ball through to right field, so it will not be a 1-2-3 inning. And Riles touches first base, and they have their first base runner of the fifth inning.
Now batting, number 2, shortstop, Perrin Hatchin.
Katie Brown with Mental Prep 4. She has been working with student athletes of all levels, especially the high school level here for some time, but she has high school and college athletes that she's helped to get over slumps and yips and trips and falls and all kinds of stuff. And here's a throwback over to first with Riles Morris diving in safely.
You see, Katie, we don't get to see the whole field. Like, he gets the right half, I get the left half.
I have never seen this dugout over here.
This is a good thing.
This is just what we're dealing with. But Katie, I wanted to ask you something, because before you came up, we were talking about, you know, the transfer portal and recruiting and baseball and the different levels, D1, 2, 3, NAIA, JUCO. You guys have guys going all over the place.
Yes.
You know, this pitcher, he's on his way to University USC of South USC. Maddie, he's going D2, North Greenville University. Great D2.
Right.
They won the championship, a couple years ago?
Came in second last year.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's definitely a blossoming program.
For sure.
What is that like for you? Like when you sit down with Maddie, because I'm sure plenty of D1 programs he could have pursued or.
So, you know, it's funny you ask that, because we had a lot of visits that week, and North Greenville was his first visit, and he stayed there all day, and you know, they promised him innings when he comes in his freshman year to pitch, which was a big deal to him,
right?
Because he has future plans,
right?
And so to him, he knew that the portal was going to make it tough for freshmen to see the field at all. We've seen it. I've seen it with Bryce's teammates. That Bryce was a COVID kid at College of Charleston. you know, did well his first year, and then all that happened.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, that doesn't help.
No. And so I think he just, you know, Matty was like, I'm thinking realistically.
Right.
He doesn't, and he's very excited about it because he will get in there and be able to hit the mound, and he does not want to be sitting.
Yeah.
Let me put it that way.
So. I'm a believer that any kid, not any, most kids that can play the game at high school level can find a school to go to and have the opportunity to play baseball, whether it's club ball or,
for sure,
or, you know, JUCO or NAIA, like I said, whatever it is, and you just have to find what fits best for you.
Now pitching for Lucy Beckham, number 18, Charles Kelly.
You know, you gotta go and enjoy yourself. You gotta, if that's what you wanna do, find a school and play.
Yeah.
I'm all about that. And, you know, you just never know when it's going to end. I remember when Bryce hung up his cleats and, you know, it was a tough day for him.
I remember when Bryce was actually heading off to college.
I know. Really tough.
Yeah. But, so, you know, to all those players out there and all those families out there.
How bad? Number 15.
Just understand that, you know, I think everybody's process is unique. There's no right way or wrong way. I mean, you could go play for Vanderbilt and never see the field. You could go to Florida or Tech and get lots of innings, lots of work. How many games do they play in JUCO? 60-some, 70?
They carry a lot of people, yeah.
A lot of baseball, yeah.
So that brings me to my next question for you, Katie. When you have these guys that you've worked with, and I don't know if it's kind of a once and done when you work with them, or if you have clients that are coming back to you regularly for, you know, some follow up, or, you know, they are just with you every year. Let me get the season started. I don't know how that works. So I guess that might be actually one question. But as these young men go from high school and the young ladies go from high school into college and they leave and go out of the Charleston area, do you still see them or do you still communicate with them? Can you work with them remotely? And we're going to pause that for a second as we have a pop fly as Corey Brain goes into foul territory and Riles Morris pulls it down for the first out of the inning. We're in the bottom of the fifth. It's 9-6, Bengals on top, and we'll have Tyler Jimenez coming to the plate.
Katie, why don't you,
because I don't think... Number 19, catcher Tyler Jimenez.
I don't think Jim actually knows what goes into one of the sessions, so can you walk him through, like, for example, what, you know, how you would help somebody like Preston?
Yeah, absolutely. So I create a reporting that they fall asleep to at night that is a calming. I use a frequency of music that actually totally calms their brain. And I put different suggestions and affirmations in there that specifically have to do with what they're dealing with. Mm-hmm. Has their name in it, their favorite color. Calming color, different sounds that calm them, and they fall asleep to it at night.
I do
something similar. I spend a lot of nights falling asleep to reruns of Seinfeld on Netflix. Is that the same thing or is that different?
You know what? You probably have all the lines down.
I can quote with the best of them.
Exactly. So it's similar to that, you know. And but yeah, it's so I do that, and I follow up with them with a 4-minute pregame visualization that they listen to also. We do the deep breathing. We talk about, you know, I have all kinds of tools. There's different things depending on the person.
Jimenez takes the ball out to deep right field. That's going to be extra bases. He's rounding second. The throw comes in. Tommy Byrne, the relay. Here's a play at third.
Oh.
And they got him! Tyler Jimenez is out at third. Andrew Hoover with a fantastic tag. Tommy Byrne on the relay throw. What a play by the Bengals defense.
On the money.
Holy cow.
On the money. Great hit. Great hustle.
Jimenez knocked the cover off that ball into the deepest pocket of right field.
Yeah, that's the part that just keeps running.
And Lucy Beckham's defense just answers.
So with Preston, for instance, one of the things he was trying to get over was
Now batting number five, second baseman Reed Lunsford.
Just visualizing success for himself, right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and a lot of these kids, some of the big things I see are kids coming back from injury and they feel like they've lost time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they feel like they maybe aren't as good as they were before.
They're below down.
Oh, absolutely. And so you just work on that with them.
Does each player get a sports-specific or player-specific, athlete-specific recording?
Yes, they do. With their name in it, they listen to it. I ask that they listen to it every night as they're falling asleep for 3 weeks at least.
It's the same recording.
Same recording, because you want those suggestions to go in to their brain. And it's good stuff. It's really very natural, there's nothing weird about it. It's really great stuff. You know, and then I text them throughout the 3 weeks when I know that they're having games coming up. I'll text them different quotes. I'll ask them how they're doing. They can text me. Their parents, I send all the same stuff to their parents too if they're under 18.
Sure, sure.
And so, you know, the parents communicate with me. They send me their highlights a lot of times.
Yeah.
Real quick, we're going to take a look at that. Reed Lunsford with a hit by pitch as he trots down to first base. And while we have a break here to talk about it, the Bengals have had a staffing change on the mound. Charles Kelly came in here to start this inning, and he is two-thirds of an inning in now. While I have him, we're also going to announce Reese Swander.
Now batting number 11, center fielder Reese Swander.
In a minute, we'll take a look at how Sawyer Minton ended his afternoon.
Yeah, Reed's had a great day today.
This could be an inning ender.
He's got the wheel.
And it is. Aaron Ketchin and Tommy Byrne team up for the 6-4 putout. That's the end of the fifth inning. As we go to the sixth, looking up at the big board, it's 9-6. Lucy Beckham on top of the West Ashley Wildcats. As we have Thursday Night Baseball in Mount Pleasant right here at the Beck.
Well, I want to let y'all know I brought y'all some of my famous cookies.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Katie Brown.
Oh, Katie's known for her cookies.
I am known for my cookies.
Is that
cookies.
Chocolate chip?
They are chocolate chip, and they're salty sweet.
Can you? So, Katie, this is where I look at you, and I'm going to talk to you on a very personal level. My wife is listening to this broadcast. She's out of town tonight. She's listening to everything we're saying here. I need you to get that soft, convincing voice that you use on your recording. Start repeating things like, Janet, it's okay. Janet, he looks better when the cookie's been
in. Janet, all five food groups are in this cookie.
There we go.
I just put that on replay.
Yeah, over and over. That's right.
Jim, you might have to play that while she's asleep.
Listen, I'm going to have to eat that while she's asleep because I can't do it. She'll smell that on my breath from 100 miles away.
Yeah.
They're good for you. They're all organic.
Okay, we know you got to get back and want to enjoy the game with the kids.
Maddie Brown's on deck with Twitter. Oh, yeah. He's first up when they go to the play.
You got to go see him, but let's keep in touch.
Definitely. Thank you so much.
But Katie, thank you so much. One last time, it is Mental Prep for Katie Brown.
And how can people get a hold of you?
They can look on my website, which is mentalprep4.com, or they can check me out on Instagram or Twitter.
Okay.
And just give me a call. I'd prefer them give me a call rather than going into email.
What's that phone? Do you want to put the phone number?
Sure. It's 843-442-1905.
843-442-1905. Katie Brown, legendary baseball mom of the Lowcountry, and sitting on the wrong side of the bleachers tonight. I'm telling you.
Thank you,
Katie. Thank you so much. And we're here in the top of the sixth inning. Hank Epley will be our batter.
Now batting number 9, Hank Epley.
Yeah, Katie's always even keel. Never too high, never too low. Kind of like I said, the baseball.
Henry Wood bobbles it, comes up with it off of his chest, and still makes the play over at first base. You know, that's a great thing that she does. It's so good to have players seeing all sides of the preparation for this game. It's you know, we've talked about everything from yoga. We've talked about physical fitness in terms of getting ready in the gym.
Now batting. Now batting, number six, Kingston Cole.
Zach Russell working quickly, getting us a little bit off of our timing here as we.
Yeah. Yeah, he's working against the 22nd clock.
He's definitely working fast. About 6 seconds in between pitches. He's got a date after this game.
Consistently working the outside edge. So.
Yes, he is. He's working fast. He's working the outside edge, and he's working with quick
tempo,
high-speed pitches here. That one was 82. He's hit. Well, that one's off-speed down to 81. Here's across the infield. Nope. That ball gets away. Third baseman David Stallworth overthrew Henry Wood on that play, and Kingston will take the base on the error.
Breath of fresh air for him, I'm sure.
Now batting, number three, second baseman Tommy Byrne.
Jim Byrne resumes the photography role. We'll see what Zach Russell, a little peek. Up high, a little off speed. Gotta keep an eye on that little peak. It's kind of peeking tightly through that shoulder. They may pick up on a balk if he's,
Byrne goes on the ground over to second base. They'll take one of them, not get the second half, so Kingston's retired on the bags.
Yeah.
And Tommy reaches safely.
Sounds like Tommy got that one on the hands.
That definitely did not get all of the barrel.
Now batting, number 17, catcher Keegan Conroy.
Conroy sends one foul down the right side. It's going to sneak back into fair territory, and Bengals will have to hustle down there and pick that one up. But as we were saying, nice to hear about the mental and kind of the psychological prep, especially between games, you know, that off time, being able to make the most of it.
Just calm the mind.
Katie seems to really have a good handle on what athletes need, and she's made a solid contribution in both the professional sense and in the motherly sense, as she's put some great baseball players into the world here.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. This Miss Katie is she's well known, great baseball mind, and she's put it to work helping these athletes sort of get out of their own way.
Speaking of great baseball minds, I'm going to remind everybody that we've got one here behind us, the strong silent type behind us, Dave Schrock. Working the scoreboard and doing game changer. Dave? Dave's got too much going to talk. He's sitting here running buttons all over the place. Keegan Conroy down on strikes. That'll leave Tommy Byrne stranded on the bases. It's 9-6 here as we go to the bottom of the sixth inning. Bengals still on top. They're leading by three. Non-region game. This one's just for bragging rights, but it's definitely one they want to come away with the win.
I think this one's a test of character, test of fortitude. Should they win it? Maybe not. Will they win it? I think so. I think so.
Well, I don't see there's any reason why they shouldn't win it. This is a this is a well-prepared team, as we talked about earlier in the broadcast. The fact is, it's not the same team that they had last year. It's not the same team that they had even just 6 months ago at the beginning of the school year, when they were looking down the barrel of a baseball season that's changed dramatically since that time. So I think there's absolutely no reason that they shouldn't win this, and it would be great, again, talking about the psychological side of things, it's a great psychological win to come back and sweep this week after having last week, falling twice to James Island and once to Stratford High School. This is kind of evening the keel. It gives you a couple of region wins in the pocket, plus one non-region. It's just a 5A team for bragging rights.
Hey, I'd made two 5A teams so far this year, one of being the other. And both of those teams are highly ranked. And, I think Coach McConnell wants this one. He definitely wants this one.
I don't see any game Coach McConnell walks out onto the field not wanting to win and not feeling like they deserve it.
Yeah.
Which is, again, one of those viewpoints that you've got to instill in your ball players. You've got to go out there feeling like you deserve to win, you belong on that field, and there's no reason that somebody should take the win from you.
And now here's her baby.
Now batting, number two, right fielder Maddie Brown. Brown going to North Greenville, crossing the state to go play baseball next fall. And Charles Kelly is back out on the hill. He's going to have another inning of work as we start off. The bottom of the sixth. I believe we are in the bottom of the sixth here, aren't we?
That's right.
Scoreboard's doing his own thing. All right.
Thanks to your binoculars, I can actually see the scoreboard for the first time.
Yeah, it's that big glowing thing over there just to the right of the word baseball.
I see 4-2-2-1-0, but I can't read the total out. Could be a stigma if I close one eye. Nope, still can't see.
Honestly, that net just plays a little bit of interference. And it's not the clearest scoreboard they could have chosen, but it's what we have.
Well, it's good to hear that the teams are coming around and enjoying the facilities, and the program's making progress. And as you said before, there's another
shot. Maddie Brown puts a shot in the air. This one's into left center. Kingston Cole grabs it, does his spin move that he likes to do after catching the ball, and one away.
These guys are playing sharp. A lot of confidence.
Now batting, number 12, third baseman David Stallworth. Take a look over here at the defense. We really haven't done that yet tonight. On the outer track, that was Kingston Colvin left. Kevin Fagan deep out in center, and over in right, Gabe Johnson on the inner loop. Riles Morris over at first, Tommy Byrne at second, Heron Ketchum at third, and Andrew Hoover at third, excuse me, Heron Ketchum at short, and at third, Andrew Hoover covering the left side of the field. Charles Kelly is the third Bengal to take the mound tonight, and he sneaks one in. Man, that was pretty. That thing started outside and crossed inside. Holy cow, that was a nice pitch. Charles Kelly, the third Bengal up there, started with Holman Blake. He went three. Sawyer Minton came in behind Holman. Sawyer Minton ended up pitching an inning, gave up two runs on three hits. Both of those were earned runs. He struck out one, didn't walk anybody. And now Charles Kelly has another fly ball into the air in center field, and Kevin Fagan reels it in. There's two down here in the bottom of the sixth inning.
Now batting, number 13, pitcher Zach Russell.
So nobody on, two out. Bengals up by three. Saturday. Oh, wait a minute, we're gonna have a pop fly on the infield. Charles Kelly right there to grab it. Just a few steps off the mound. And the Bengals take the Wildcats off the field. 1-2-3 here in the sixth. They still lead by three. Baseball on a beautiful Thursday in Mount Pleasant, where the grass is freshly cut, the field is freshly dragged, And the Bengals are winning here at the back. Into the booth, Mr. Jimmy Doyle, head coach of the freshman B team, and fresh off a 13-12 victory over at Park West. Jimmy Doyle.
Scary.
Jimmy Doyle, you've got
very
to take
scary it. Game. Very scary game.
There you go, Jimmy. You got the mic.
Very scary game.
You were up 11-2 at one point, and it's a 13-12 win. I mean, not for nothing, but there are plenty of cardiologists in this town who are looking at you saying, we're going to get some work out of these guys.
Yeah, they definitely aged me a couple years. Just a lot of unforced errors, but proud of them. They didn't hang their head. They battled back. And they continued to hit the ball well. So proud of them. I mean, adversity, and then they showed up. Turned it around, we got the victory, that's all that matters.
That's all that matters, but man, the heart attack kids tonight.
Yeah.
Jim, welcome back to the clubhouse.
That's what we've now called this place. We just got invited to my first.
Oh, we're not going with the chicken coop?
No, not going with the chicken coop. So welcome back to the clubhouse. Did you get a chance to...
Over here. Oh, well, we've got a couple of
winners.
Fresh from a victory at Park West Recreation Complex.
What's up, y'all?
The baby Bengals themselves. Peyton Doyle and Jackson Byrne.
We got 18 in here? 16?
Rookie, can you grab my muscle
now? How batting? Number 5, Andrew Hoover. Andrew Hoover at the plate. Bengals with a 3-run lead. Tyler Jimenez thought he was going to get the strike call. He did not. That was well wide. I'm not sure what he was looking at. 80-mile-an-hour strike 3 has Hoover going down swinging. And there's one away. Oh, we have a pinch hitter here. And good to see Ryan Rogan coming to the plate. Now batting, number 4, Ryan Rogan.
I think you messed him up there, Jim.
Well, anything we can do to help. This kid's pitching as quick as possible. He is really quick pitching these Bengals. And Rogan says, no, sir. Knocks one up the middle. Corey Brain cannot make the play, and it's a base hit to left. Left center, that is, for Ryan Rogan coming off the bench. Now batting, number 11, center fielder, Kevin Fagan. Pickoff attempt over to first base. We have a runner for Rogan. Who is that?
Joel?
It might be Gabe Johnson running for him.
Is that Gabe? Yeah, it looks like it is.
Gabe Johnson might have come back in just like that. Let Ryan bat and let Gabe run.
Same spot every time.
0-2 pitch. Fagan's watched a couple on the outside. Russell's got a fast move over to first base, but it's borderline a balk if he doesn't step that foot off fast enough. Russell at 88 miles an hour again. He's got back to the future speed. This is a DeLorean he's tossing. And Fagan goes down on strikes.
Where's this pitcher going? Is he committed anywhere?
Yeah, this Zach Ross is going to University of South Carolina.
Now batting, number 12, Riles Morris.
Healthy swing there.
Riles isn't getting cheap.
Zach Russell. working quickly, tosses over to first base.
Now, Zach's not careful. He throws to that spot that Ryle's kind of likes. If Ryle's on time, you say goodbye.
And he keeps coming wide. A right-handed pitcher comes across the plate. Many of his pitches are landing on the right side of the plate. For Ryles Morris, that's an inside pitch as a left-handed batter, and he does it again. Ryles tees one off, and that's going to be out of play.
Well,
actually, no. It was just misjudged. Third baseman David Stallworth came down about 4 feet away from it. I don't know where he tracked that to, if he thought it was going over the fence and just gave up on it, but the wind pushed it back in, and he was only about 4 or 5 feet from that ball. So a ball and two strikes now, one on, two out here in the top of the seventh inning. And Russell sends one wide. Boys, you guys came in with a 13-12 victory. Although, I think the bigger thing we need to talk about is where the 11-2 lead went. There was some...
It went to right field.
Good block kick.
There was a lot of baseball between 11-2, where I saw it, and then 11-4, and then all of a sudden 11-9, and finally 13-12 at the end.
That was it. Come on.
Speaking of the end, Ryles Morris goes down on strikes. The Bengals will strand one after... Ryan Rogan gets a nice base hit up the middle. And we go to the bottom of the seventh. Bengals leading 9-6. All right, get up here close to the microphone. Tell me about that B-team game tonight. You guys won it. I'll give you that. But I need to hear a little bit more about it.
Quick rundown what happened. We won. Yeah, but there was a lot of errors. But we made it there. We had lots of good hits. We got lots of hit by pitches, a couple walks.
This might be the worst interview I've ever
done. We had some good picks by my man Billy Clary. He's an absolute legend for picking that ball.
Whose kid is this?
And I just want to say, Peyton Doyle was very good at pitching today.
Did we not lock this door?
And.
You know what?
And we threw it a third out.
Get your spicy chicken sandwich. Peyton, get up here. Let me talk to you for a second. Go away, kid.
You can give me your spice.
Peyton Doyle, tell me a little bit about what happened. You were pitching tonight?
Yes, sir.
How'd you do out there on the mound?
I pitched the contact really well.
Yes.
Made defense make plays. But that's really good.
Fantastic. All right, we're getting these guys some media training.
How about it? Number 3, left fielder Tate Westerveld.
That's what happened.
Yeah.
Well, there you have it, folks. From the mouths of the men who were on the field doing battle themselves.
They came to cheer on the big brothers. And guys, you know what happens if we hold them here, right?
We win.
We have chicken dinner.
It's chicken dinner, just like you're having right now. 9-6 is the score as we're in the bottom of the seventh inning. West Ashley, the home team, after this relocated game from West Ashley to the Beckham Stadium here.
Oh!
Charles Kelly throws a 60-mile-an-hour off-speed ball, and it's just 2-1.
It was drifting in. It just didn't get the wind behind it.
No, I couldn't find where it was going. It didn't have the wings. Fell low.
There we go.
Oh, that was a strike last inning. Holy cow. 3-1 is the count now. Charles Kelly trying to keep these Bengals on top. Tate Westerveld, the left fielder, throwing some awkward hip thrusts out between every pitch. And he swings. It's now a full count. Westerveld.
Mental toughness right here.
Right here. This is where Katie Brown has a difference. This is where she makes a difference in this.
This is it. For both guys.
Bottom of the seventh inning, full count. Trailing by 3. Gotta get on base.
And we like that ball hit to Kevin.
Drifts back. And deep in center field, there's one away.
Yeah.
Now batting, number 20, first baseman Henry Wood.
Henry Wood has been dangerous with the bat so far this evening. He one-hopped the fence and bounced it off the wall. Had an extra base hit with that. Don't need any more of that, but if he does get a hold of one, one in the air for an easy out in the field would not be a bad move. Charles Kelly's done a good job of getting these guys to hit into outs. Whether in the air or on the ground, he's been productive in that regard. And this one's chopped down the first baseline. West Ashley coach will take it and send it back to the mound. 9-6, your score. One ball, one strike, one out. One man at the plate, and that is the first baseman. And wearing his blue Bruce Bolt batting gloves. He swings and misses. It's now a ball and two strikes. No Bengals baseball going on the rest of this weekend. I don't think. Actually, we do have baseball on Saturday, don't we? Or has that been canceled yet? This is a base hit to right field as Henry Wood puts one on the ground in the 1-2 gap. Say again? Yeah, that's if the rain doesn't knock that game out.
This is the part of the lineup where... Number 15.
That's Corey Brayman.
Now batting, number 15. Shortstop Corey Brayman.
Yeah, I think this is the part of the lineup where you definitely want to make a dent.
It's a Burnett. I don't know.
Now running. Tyler Burnett comes in to run for Henry Wood, putting a little bit of speed on the bags as Corey Brain comes to the plate. Corey Brain, currently the shortstop, was tonight's starting pitcher.
Jim, I think last game, every other player that came to the plate was Tyler Burnett.
You know, it in fact was. That was the scrimmage where West Ashley showed up. They had no numbers, no names on their jerseys. They gave us no starting lineup. We had to pick people out of the hat, and we were getting all kinds of grief from the West Ashley parents saying, that's not him, or that's not him, or my son. You know, we apologized then, and I'll apologize now, but that's on the good folks on the coaching staff from West Ashley. You got to let me know who's playing if you want it called right.
Yeah. You got the runner on first. He's trying to extend his lead here.
I know that maybe forcing faces mistake. On these kids.
Got to be smart with the ball here.
Tyler Burnett's already been on the bases once tonight.
Keegan's going to come up ready to fire every time.
He's gone. Oh.
Keegan, he's got to be careful of that staying down in that framing position too long.
Keegan is sitting low in the catcher's box there. Not popping up to anticipate that runner. I'd like to see that a little bit more.
Here we go. That's the sign of that double steal, is that double hop. If he stays
this
on
ball
the
could be caught. It is. Riles Morris is under it, and there's two away. So the Bengals are one out away from taking the victory here tonight. They got out in front early.
Now batting, number 19, catcher Tyler Jimenez.
A lot of pressure on this guy. Here's, you know.
Got hit a three-run home run with one guy on base.
Well, I mean, he's got to extend the game. You know, that could be as simple as a base hit, line drive, but it's a lot easier said than done.
Jimenez has been productive this evening. He's been dangerous. He went to right field, I believe, the last time he was up. Have fun. Brought a couple of base runners in. He's responsible for at least two of those runs up there.
Jim, you see that runner when he takes that double hop after that primary lead? It's usually one of the keys of a late, you know, a delayed steal. If the catcher's on his knees, he's gone.
This ball is in the air. This could be a game ender.
I hope
Gabe
it is.
Johnson out in right field. He's got it. In the words of Jack Buck, that's a winner. 9-6 is your final score as Lucy Beckham beats its second 5A opponent of the season. They took down Wando, they fell to Stratford, but this week they take West Ashley. It's a 3-game sweep for the week, twice over Colleton County, twice here at the Beck. This one was a road game, but we played it on friendly soil. Winning pitcher tonight. Who's going to take the win on this one, Dave? We've got, let's see here. I believe that's still going to be Holman Blakely.
Holman did 3, so I don't know. I think it might be Charles Cameron.
See, that seventh run was scored in the third inning. So that's going to be Holman Blakely with the win. It's going to be Holman Blake with the win. Charles Kelly with the save.
Definitely
and Corey Brain. Corey for tonight. Corey Brain is going to be on the hook for the loss. Bengals got out early. 4-2-2 in the first three innings. One more in the fourth. Nothing in the fifth, sixth, or seventh. But the good news is, the Wildcats did all their scoring in the first four. They put 1, 1, 2, and 2 up, and they also went runless in the fifth, sixth, and seventh. We'll see if we can go over here to the box score for a moment. Tonight's box score, Lucy Beckham, 9 runs on 11 hits, no errors, which, you know, we talked about this earlier in the season. We have to get rid of the errors. That's it. That's it right there. Take those errors, get rid of them, start moving the bases, moving the runners around the bases, hit random. Those two simple things are going to win baseball games.
Yeah.
Lucy Beckham, 9 runs on 11 hits, no errors. And West Ashley Wildcats, 6 runs on 8 hits, 5 errors that on their side. So a well-fought, well-earned victory for the boys in gray. Let's go back here and take a look at the upcoming. On Monday, we'll be back here at the Beck, taking on region rival May River at 6:30 p.m. Next Wednesday, we'll get on the bus, head down to the bottom corner of the state. We'll take on May River at their house. And next Friday, the big game, Matt. Another 5A.
Yeah, ESPN opponent. Will be here. I'm sure Lee Greenwood will be back. Maybe Whitney Houston will.
Parking for the satellite trucks will be in the gravel lot here.
Well, I was going to say we could have Whitney sing the national anthem, but I just kind of ruined that.
Well, we'll see.
Because she won't be here.
In spirit, Matt. In spirit. Next Friday, we'll be taking on Somerville Varsity's Green Wave under the leadership of one P.J. Morlando, who is currently projected to go number 16 in the draft. And
but you know, I'll tell you something though, Jimmy. No doubt, P.J.'s a great ball player. And everybody's going to give him respect. Everybody's going to follow. But I'll tell you, the game plan going into it, you as a ball player, as an opponent, you've got to be able to look past that.
Well, you've got 8 other people that you've got to deal with, and he's just one.
He's one guy. They got another guy, Carson Messina. He throws gas just like this guy did tonight. So this is a great
Carson
little
Messina moment. Throws in the mid-90s. Yep. He'll touch 98.
Yeah, so make sure you got all your protective gear on. But,
you know what, Matt? I might even wear a cup next Friday just for the sake of
it. Yeah, well, I just had the mindset when I played that, you know, a lot of times, and I've talked to some of the players, and they, you know, you hear guys like, oh, look at this guy, look at, you know, Taj Marchand, or, you know, these other players that are, you know, spectacular players for their age, right? But you got to go into it thinking, to yourself, they got to face me.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, that's the preparation that we talked about.
Preparation.
That's the mental toughness going into it, knowing right. that I'm here, I deserve this, I have earned this spot, and I can beat the guy that I'm facing right now.
you got to have that belief in yourself. You know, they say bet on yourself. And, you know, whether that takes you the night before, whether that takes you... I was telling Coach McConnell, I used to drive past our Little League field on the school bus on a rainy day. And I'd start praying at school and crossing my fingers and doing everything I could to make sure that field wasn't rained out. Because there's nothing I wanted more that day than to get on that field and play baseball. I had a routine. I got to the field and I never cared who was in the bullpen for the other team. Never cared. Everybody else would be like, oh, you know, they're throwing this guy, what this guy's throwing. I don't care about him. He's got to face me.
Yeah, there's always been talk, especially when you come up through those travel years and those 8U, 10U, 13U years, and you hear people talk about, oh, they've got a lefty. Oh, this guy can throw 85. Oh, this guy put 3 over the fence.
That doesn't matter. That was yesterday.
That doesn't matter.
Baseball is a game.
It's today.
What have you done for me lately?
And every day can be different. Every day is a new competition. They say in football, any given Sunday.
Right.
It's the same thing right here in baseball.
It really is. And I think, you know, you come to it with the mindset that you're going to succeed. And if you put it this way, like Katie said, put something else in your mind. If you're out there thinking about how fast this guy throws, how nasty his curve is, or, you know, how you got to time it up, you do all that in the on-deck circle, right? When you get into that box, you're not thinking.
You got to be a hitter.
You just got to be athletic. That's it. And play the game you've always played that you love to play, because not many people can play this sport. And you got to go out there and dominate. And guess what's going to happen? One or two things is going to happen. You're going to win the at-bat, or you're going to lose the at-bat. And guess what? No matter which one, doesn't matter, you'll get another shot.
There was an old minor league coach that I used to talk to, nice guy, and he spent many years coaching baseball, knew more about baseball than I'll ever know, probably forgot more than I'll ever know. And his approach was always yes, 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 until it's no.
Yeah.
And you've got to have that approach. And that's what these guys have got to take into next Friday as they go into the game against Somerville. But you know what? Before we get to Somerville and before we get to PJ Morlando and Carson Messina and the rest of that Green Wave, we've got to get through May River.
We've got region games with them,
and those games mean something. The Somerville game is just like tonight. It's bragging rights.
Right.
It's a measure.
Well, I think it helps with your strength.
We'll see where you are.
Whoever looks at the strength of scheduling and. Sure, we took on the number 20 high school in the state, and
we sweep May River, and we're going to the playoffs now.
Yeah, no matter what. And we've got May River, we've got Bluffton, we've got Hilton Head, we've got a lot of baseball, we've got a lot of region baseball. We cannot look past anybody. We're on a good streak right now, but there's a lot of baseball there yet to play. And I quite frankly, Matt, I'm looking at these guys that we saw tonight. And this is a good team. This isn't even the best Lucy Beckham baseball team that we can put out there, but it's a good one.
The one you saw tonight, this team, with this mindset, having fun, having strikeout dances in the outfield, that this team would have beat James Island.
Absolutely, absolutely. But we went into that game saying, we're playing James Island.
Can't do it. That's right.
Matt, I think... we're just about there. The tarps are going down on the mound and at the plate. We have some guests up here right now. It reminds me that I need to send some love out to Catherine Morris's dad. And I have been derelict in my duties talking about my families of the game. And we need to bring that back. We're going to have to bring that back next week.
Yep, Stu Ketchin, I owe you one.
We're going to have to start with maybe the Morrises, maybe the Ketchins. There's a lot of great families here. And it's not lost on us that we would not be doing this if it weren't for them and because of them. And so we appreciate all of them that listen. Hopefully you're still enjoying Beckham baseball, even though we are talking over much of it. But let's just wrap this thing up. We missed tree talk tonight. It is a beautiful tree out there in center field, but we didn't get to talk about it. We'll have to revisit that on Monday.
You can see it now.
But tonight, Your Lucy Beckham Varsity Bengals walk off the field winners in this non-region 5A competition game. 9-6 is your final score. We will see you Monday. Chances are not great that we'll play B-team baseball doubleheaders on Saturday. Weather's looking pretty rough for Friday night and Saturday. Field conditions might not allow it here at the Beck. But we will be here Monday. Weather looks good then. 6:30 is game time. Tune back in here on YouTube, and we will see you then. Thanks for coming out to the ballpark. Have a great night.